Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2022. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is evidence taking on the draft of the Fourth National Planning Framework, or NPF4. This is the second of five evidence sessions that the committee will be holding on NPF4. The focus on today's session is on planning, and we will be hearing from two panels. On the 1st of February, we'll be exploring issues around housing, and on the 8th of February, we'll be looking at local government issues. The committee will hear from the minister on the 22nd of February. For today, I would like to welcome to the committee the first panel, and that's Robbie Calvert, who's from the practice and research. He's a practice and research officer from RTPI Scotland, Claire Simmons, who's the founder and chair of Planning Democracy, Ilse McFarlane, who is the director of the Built Environment Forum Scotland, Barbara Cummins, who's the vice chair of Planning Aid Scotland, Christina Geiger, who is the president of the Royal Incorporation of Architects in Scotland. Thank you very much for joining us today. And we're going to move straight to questions. Witnesses, if you wish to respond or contribute to this discussion, please add an R to the chat box to indicate this. What we tend to do is have a practice of whoever's asking the question will ask the question and then maybe direct it to someone to initiate, but don't feel that that means you can't come in. So use the R in the chat function and I or the clerks will pick that up. And I'm going to just start with the first question. The draft National Planning Framework represents a significant shift in national planning policy, with a new focus on issues of place, livability, well-being, and emissions reduction. Is the Scottish planning system set up to deliver such outcomes, or are changes needed? And if so, what changes would you like to see? And I'm going to direct that question initially to Robbie Calvert and then Ilse McFarlane. Robbie.
Yeah, hope everyone can hear me okay. Just to set things off, we very much support the travel direction of the framework. There's some very ambitious and laudable elements proposed within it. And we really hope that this lifts the kind of collective aspirations of what as Scotland thinks planners and planning can provide on a number of outcomes. So tackling the twin climate and biodiversity crisis, achieving inclusive green economic recovery and reducing health inequalities across the country. And we very much support the inclusion of an importance attached to the sort of place-based approaches throughout the framework, especially embedding the 20-minute neighbourhood concept and various things, including having a stronger presumption against out-of-town retail. But throughout this process, we've very much maintained that success will be in the implementation of the framework, not the preparation. And I know a number of stakeholders are keen to see the delivery plan, which we understand will be published alongside the final framework in June. And we understand Scottish Government are working with Scottish Futures Trust on this, drafting it at the moment. We hope that the process by which the engagement happens to that is as inclusive and as collaborative as the entire process has been so far for this draft framework. But we very much believe that to support the ambitions in this plan, we need to have appropriate resourcing in place. And so all along, we've been advocating for publication of a capital investment plan alongside a final framework. This is what is seen in Ireland, which was published alongside their national planning framework. But we also need to consider the resource requirements of the planning system to implement this plan. And whilst we welcome proposed fee increases, we do not believe that this will sufficiently address resourcing issues in the planning system. So our research has shown that since 2009, we've had a cut of a third in staff numbers and budgets diminishing by 42% in real terms, and also a number of new and unfunded duties coming through, which we see in the draft framework, but also resulting from the Planning Act as well. Alongside this, we also have an issue of pipeline of planners. So over the next 10 years, we think there'll be a demand for an additional 680 planners in the sector. We need to ensure that there's enough planners to be able to process the applications. And to address this, we've actually called for a comprehensive resource and skills strategy to be published alongside the delivery programme. And this would consider issues including the capacity issues, both current and predicted, but also the new skills and training requirements resulting from the framework. And there's a number of examples in there, but for example, the lifetime carbon assessments and upskilling planners in terms of their sort of climate literacy will be critical. And then we want to set out the plan of how to ensure that we have a stronger pipeline of planners as well necessary to implement this framework over the next 10 years. So a similar strategy has been promised alongside planning reform down in England. So I think there's been an acknowledgement that resource is required to deliver this. I'll just stop there for now, let someone else come in.
Thanks very much. Elsa, I'd like to bring you in and on this one as well. And also kind of add to my question, you know, because we've got a couple of policies right there in the kind of national policies that focus on climate and nature restoration, I would also like to get a sense of whether you believe that the goals for climate change and emission reductions within the draft framework are achievable and are consistent with other policies in the draft. So Elsa, if you could pick up on the first question about planning, this planning setup system being set up to deliver, but then also maybe bringing in your thoughts around the climate emissions reduction piece.
Thank you very much, convener. I will support much of what Robbie Calvert, RTPI, has just said around the delivery regarding the planning system. Is the system set up to deliver? I would say that there are some things within NPF4 that don't necessarily point as strongly towards the green aims as we could hope for. I would say that issues around embodied carbon and our existing places are perhaps not fully realised within NPF4, particularly because there is not the clear links to other strategies, such as the heat and building strategy, for example. And with that, around delivery, there's been a concern from a number of FES members that this national planning framework has the opportunity to link to building standards much more clearly, because through that is part of the way that delivery can be met, and that these are areas that need to work sort of hand in hand rather than necessarily be separated. We would also say that the system more generally needs clarity around the hierarchy of policies themselves across the Scottish Government, but also considering policies within the document itself. I'm aware that there isn't necessarily intended to be waiting across the document, but unfortunately, that does mean that a lot is left up to individual planning departments, and also sets up a potentially adversarial planning system quite unnecessarily, because that clarity is not given. And that potential adversarial nature doesn't benefit our places, and it doesn't benefit our communities. And I think that one of your initial questions was regarding and NPF is very much sort of much more people and community focused. And I would say that community engagement and the potential for sort of local place plans and their integration within the national planning framework isn't as fully articulated as we could ensure. Does that help to
yeah.
answer?
That's great.
To answer your question.
Thank you very much. Yeah, no, that's great. So I see that Claire would like to come in, and then Robbie, I see you want to come back in, so I'll bring you in again. So, Claire.
Yes, thank you. I would just like to say that we're members of BEFS as well, Planning Democracy, and members of BEFS, and I very much would re-emphasize what Ailsa has said. Thank you for saying that about communities, Ailsa, and also what Robbie's saying around fees. And I think, you know, our concerns about planning being resourced by fees alone is that it needs a bit more independence, because the fees come from the developers, who are seen as the chief customers, and that might translate as them seeing that the priorities need to be to assist them with you know, their planning applications or whatever. So I think we need to have a separate resourcing for allocated for community stuff, and for also things like ecologists and so on, and I think that needs to be separate. On to I think that you were talking about the climate and biodiversity emergencies being given a priority, and we really welcome their prominence in this document, and we don't underestimate the scale of the change that this heightened emphasis requires, from, you know, taking it from a narrow focus on delivering the government economic strategy to including priorities on climate and nature. That's great, but changing the default orientation of a system that has long seen development as an intrinsically good thing, I think will take some doing, and the training and resourcing that comes with that is really crucial. You know, given that all built development will generate climate impacts, you know, I would emphasise what Ailsa was saying about the, you know, strong policy guidance, but also on the prevention of non-climate friendly development. So we want to scale up the good stuff, like the renewables, but we crucially need to scale down the bad stuff. So we shouldn't be planning or consenting for any new development that will contribute to climate change, or the loss of biodiversity, unless it's absolutely necessary to meet social needs. And that's going to set up some sort of battleground, I know, you know, about how necessity is defined, and that's where the skills need to come in, and the resourcing. There is one part of the climate policy that I have a concern about, and this is 2C, and it states that if a development generates significant emissions, it should not be supported unless the developer can demonstrate it would not be viable, or that it is in the long-term public interest. And this reflects the tradition of discretionary planning and leaves space for decision makers to justify the development that doesn't meet the required standard. And I'm not sure what developments this is aimed at, whether it's coal-fired power stations or you know, housing on developed greenfield sites or spaceports or what, but surely the climate emergency is not in the public interest. So what kind of circumstances are there where the public interest overrides the climate imperative? So we have to be careful, I think, that we're not creating a new language game on technical definitions around viability. You know, if a development is not viable, does that mean you don't have to pay attention to the climate? At what point do you want that development? And I think that's where we need clarity. And the outcome of the policy clause, I feel, will be that it will generate an industry for you know, viability studies, and plenty of employment opportunities for consultants, you know, to argue the toss on whether development is in the public interest, rather than incentivizing developers to construct less carbon intensive developments. So we're recommending, you know, sort of the wording needs to be strengthened to make it clear that there is a presumption only in favour of development that is strictly necessary, and better to state that the development that contributes significantly to climate emissions is just not acceptable, only in very exceptional circumstances.
Thanks very much, Claire. So I mentioned that I was going to bring in Christiana and then Robbie, but I think I'll go to Barbara because she hasn't spoken yet. So we'll go Christiana and then Barbara. And then if we've got time on this, because we've got lots of questions, so maybe I'll bring you in again, Robbie, but I also would like to move on. So, Christiana.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for being here. I mean, we've covered a huge amount of ground already this morning, so I don't want to go over anything, but it's more of a slightly broader brush response to your questions this morning, is that the construction, operation and maintenance of the built environment accounts for about 45% of total carbon emissions. So when we're talking about climate emissions policy and are the goals achievable, I think even though this is a spatial plan for Scotland, the alignment to 2045 in terms of our map to net zero as well is also absolutely critical. And there are a few key things missing or emphasis is missing in this document that would help that alignment, including our existing building stock and how we are actually looking at the, sorry, I love a statistic, 85% you know, buildings that are standing today will be here in 2045. So how are we addressing them? And I feel that the emphasis throughout the document is very light on that approach, and it plays a really key role in achieving those goals in terms of net zero and emissions. So that's just something to kind of bear in mind. And I think another way of looking at this in terms of the question about is the setup, you know, right to deliver the outcomes that we're looking for? And I think the planning process is the first statutory stage. It's so important, but it is one part of the process. And I think the opportunity to define a route map and targets for industry, which really does have its head in the sand, especially around climate, is a huge opportunity through this document, because it's got the potential to affect change within that planning system that's that first statutory stage. So the opportunity to embed the ambition at that first stage sits within this document. And I feel that that can be really brought to the fore, because in the building industry, for example, you've got planning, Ailsa mentioned, building control, building standards, so important, and then procurement. That's the delivery process. The delivery doesn't just happen at the end in terms of construction. The delivery is the whole thing. So land acquisition comes before, you know, and it's joining those dots to make sure that the policies and the framework is set up so that the goals that are achievable run through the whole system. And I think even though this is a spatial plan, I think it, as that first statutory stage, it has the opportunity to really grab that opportunity a little bit more than it does at present.
Thank you very much, Christina. Helpful. And I really appreciate you bringing that perspective in. And I love stats. 85% of buildings will still be standing in 2045. I mean, I walk around, you know, any town or village that I'm in, and I'm just like, how are we going to do this? You know, really, how are we going to do the heat in the homes and things like that? So that certainly needs to be addressed. Barbara.
Thank you very much, and good morning, everybody. Thanks for the opportunity to speak on behalf of PAS. We support communities to engage in decision making that affect their places. So very much echo what others have said, and I think there's been a lot of talk about the additional work that will come to planners and new duties, new requirements, new policies. But actually, this is a statutory plan for the whole of Scotland, and communities also will struggle with some of the concepts and perhaps some of the lack of clarity around priorities. And it's really important that we build trust in the planning system in Scotland, because we know, and Claire has highlighted this, you know, developers are seen as being the bad guys. Well, we need development. We need the right development in the right place. And whilst planning has always been about achieving balance, I think that lack of clarity in some of the policies around how this will be implemented is really important. And the Chief Planner in her evidence pointed to the fact that local communities can be part of that delivery mechanism. Everything happens in a local place. This might be a national plan, but it all happens in a local place. We want to stop these things, the new requirements, being tick box assessments that communities look at and go, well, yes, you said you were going to do this, but actually it's just in a written assessment and it's not happening on the ground. And through ensuring that communities are engaged in the process and involved in what happens, then we'll build that trust. But they need to know the basis on which those decisions are starting. So if the climate emergency is number one, then I think we should be quite clear about that, so that there's no debate and communities are clear that that's where we're starting from.
Thank you very much for your response. And Robbie, do you briefly want to come back in on that climate question, and then I'll move on to questions from
thank
colleagues.
Thank you. Yeah, I'll keep it brief. I'm really just supporting Barbara and Elsa's comments there on the sort of clarity of language used in this document. It is part of the statutory development plan, and planners are going to have to defend these policies that appeal. So whilst we appreciate there's inherent complexities with planning, still a need to give sort of clear consideration and stress test some of the policies in the framework, provide as much certainty and clarity for decision makers as possible. So consider and appreciating the point Scottish Government made in regards to being too descriptive in the use of definitions, we still feel there's an opportunity to provide further guidance and detail on a number of policies. And regarding net zero ambitions, if you look at, for example, Policy 19 on green energy, the planners are to support development proposals unless the impacts are considered unacceptable. Well, unacceptable is not defined within the framework, and that could lead to a lot of challenge at appeal and public inquiry as well.
Thanks so much for that. I really appreciate it, because it's that kind of detail that you're giving us, that, you know, policy 19, this phrase, accept the word acceptable, right? That's very helpful for us, because we need to understand what you need to know, what people in the sector need to have really spelled out. So we're all moving together in this in a good way. I'd like to move on and bring in Miles Briggs, my colleague Miles Briggs, and he's got a number of questions for the panel.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask specifically a question with regards to public involvement, whether or not the panel felt that the policies set out in MPF 4 actually make provision for meaningful public engagement in the development of the plan, but also developing the management processes as well, and wondered whether or not you felt that there is the opportunity for the public to get involved, and if not, what would you like to see change around that? So I may be bringing Claire Simmons, and if anyone else would like to come in, an hour in the chat as well. Thanks.
Thank you. Yes, public involvement. I think with regard to the local development plan consultation is running at the same time at the moment, and I think that's that's going to set out some of the ways that the public could get involved in these things. I think that with regard to appeals, as what we've been saying, I concur with what Robbie was saying about appeals and have we got a plan-led system? And I think if we're going to get people involved in planning, then we need to stick to the planning system, which is policy one, but that just really states what is in the legislation at the moment, and I think that we have to have far more monitoring of policies that go contrary to the local development plan. We have to have far more strict language about developments that do not comply with the local development plan, because with regard to anybody drawing up a local place plan or getting involved in their local development plan, if the decisions that are made are lots of exceptions to that plan, then that makes a mockery of the public engagement. So I think we really need to ensure that the wording is strict and that we have to comply more with the plan. And with that, we think the right of appeal for communities to appeal any decision that goes contrary to that local development plan is a really good incentive. And we asked for this in the planning legislation. I know it's not within the gift of the committee to introduce this through the national planning framework, but I think it still remains a point that if we're going to stick with the plans, then we need incentives for developers to do that.
Thanks, Claire. And I'm going to bring in Barbara.
It's always notoriously difficult to get lots and lots of local people involved in the development plan process, and the further away that feels from people, the harder it is. So at a national level, these concepts, they're not real to people. It's only when things start to happen on the ground that it becomes real, and then they get engaged, and then they realise actually they've missed an opportunity. I think that's why the local place plans will be absolutely key, because it gives communities a route to influencing the plans that happen above them, if you like. And the chief planner talked about flexibility within the system to allow things to change so that local communities are actively influencing what's happening, not just in their local area, but how that might affect more broadly a local development plan that's perhaps out of sync with their local place plan. So it's really important that that MPF4 supports that process and recognises that process. I was really encouraged to hear the chief planner talking about that, because it's not explicit in MPF4 in that regard, but it's implicit, and obviously the legislation is in place. But again, that means that we need clarity within MPF4, because local communities will be looking at that, at how that influences the plans that they create.
Thank you very much for that. The committee have received a number of written submissions which expressed concern, and we've already touched on this already this morning about possible inconsistencies between the national planning spatial strategy and national planning policies. So I think we sort of know what they look like. Language is sometimes a barrier, with different words meaning different things to planners, and the emphasis on what that might mean. But I wondered if the panel had any ways of rectifying some of these issues which have been put to us, and how we could actually make sure that both local councils but also the national planning strategy actually match up in delivering what we want to see in NPF4. I don't know if maybe bring Robbie in, as you had touched upon some of this earlier, and if anyone else wants to.
Thanks, Miles. Certainly one thing we said in our response is we think there needs to be real consideration of the read across of this document. So you refer to the sort of spatial strategy. So part one, for example, the spatial principles section has some really important concepts in there, compact growth and balanced development. But we find it doesn't really pull through the rest of the document through into part three, into the actual policy section. So we think as a starting point that any of the spatial priorities set out in section one have a very clear pull through into section three, and we think that make planners' lives a lot easier and communities as well when they're looking at this document. In terms of, I think we can maybe reduce potential conflicts of policies there, and again understanding that there is inherent complexity with every planning application. But you know, an example there would be back to policy 19 again, which is a more permissive policy if you'd read it at first in terms of delivering renewables. But then compared with policy 32 there, it's actually potentially a less permissive policy environment for onshore wind in reference to some of the wildland areas. So there is actually quite a lot of conflict and contradiction throughout the plan. So clear understanding of the read across of various elements will be important to success.
Thanks for that. Ailsa, did you want to come in as well on that question? Thanks.
But you're on, Ailsa. Oh, no audio yet. All right,
there we go.
There you go. It's not you. Broadcast handles everything.
Well, I pressed the button, so hopefully you can hear me now. To agree with what Robbie had said about the read across between different parts of the document, and maybe to pick up on a few points of detail that you mentioned, across the document, we felt that the historic and existing environment is not referenced fully where it could be, which I think brings in a lot of the things that we've been discussing about sort of various policies, as well as sort of the ability to meet net zero. But there are specific policies, such as one of the successful place qualities, quality six. It mentions adaptability, and that our places should be maintained over time. And I think that we'd very much want to say that this is more than a quality of successful places. This is in fact quite fundamental, that aspect of maintaining our places so we can reuse and repurpose. And those are qualities that are mentioned in the document, but are maybe not made as fundamental as they might be. And I think going back to the interconnectedness of various things, infrastructure first is mentioned within policy 8, but the Infrastructure Commission report specifically mentioned that our existing housing is part of infrastructure, and that to enhance and maintain existing assets ahead of new build was one of the principles. And I would say that within infrastructure, the document almost purposefully manages to just skip over our housing and our homes as part of infrastructure, which means that some of the principles don't tie together as well as they should. And again, the blue and green infrastructure, the long-term stewardship and effective management and maintenance plans are referenced in relation to that, but not perhaps in relation to other developments. And obviously, what Christina was mentioning earlier about sort of 85% of our environment, built environment will still be existing in 45. It's a case of we should be building with maintenance and those plans for stewardship and for the future integrated within that. And just to touch on things that potentially, as Mr. Briggs was asking about sort of community involvement as well, from the historic environment perspective, there are a number of documents that, if they were represented within NPF4, would help local places and the authorities dealing with those places to better represent them. Historic environment records are missing. Planning advice note 2/2011 is missing. And it's not just that the Historic Environment Policy for Scotland itself isn't perhaps as clearly referenced within the document, but those two, the Historic Environment Records and the Planning Advice Note, what they do is currently within Scottish Planning Policy, they're offering a better understanding and protections for our non-designated assets, which is around 95% of our existing historic environment. And so they provide that wider understanding of communities' own place and their own appreciation of the historic environment, rather than necessarily focusing on designated assets, which are obviously extremely important, but it's enabling the document to see that balance. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And I see that Barbara, then Robbie, Claire and Christina, everybody wants in on this one, Miles. So Barbara.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to take a slightly different tack on this because we're reading the document as a linear document, and lots of people have said about how you need to read it as a whole, you need to balance all the parts. And yes, there will be a degree of conflict because we like a wind farm, but we don't like it there. So there's got to be that. But I think we can use digital technology to support how everything hangs together. It can't be beyond the wit of man to have lots of links and connections that if somebody doesn't understand what's in front of them, they can click on that, get a definition, get a read through to the document that it refers to or to other policies. And I think the Scottish Government is investing a lot of money in digital technology. NPF4 could look very different, and it could help people navigate that complexity and read it in a more rounded way, so you're not just going through from page one to page whatever it is at the end. You're travelling yourself around the system and educating yourself around what's required.
Thanks very much for that perspective. Robbie.
Very much supporting Barbara's point there on digital technology. We were quite disappointed to see no reference to the Scottish Government's digital planning strategy in the delivery section of the draft plan. But just to build on my point there in terms of how can we support planners to implement this plan, I think a lot of it is also to do the complementarity this plan has with other plans and strategies. And you know, very much the devil is in the detail with this plan, but some of the detail exists elsewhere and some of that detail is out of date. So we identified a number of plans and strategies and national policy statements which we consider out of date, including Scotland's National Marine Plan, which is 2015, Designing Streets Guidance, 2010, Creating Places, 2013, the Development Planning and Management Transport Appraisal Guidance, 2011, the Town Centre and Retail Methodologies, 2007. These were not produced in the same policy context that we find ourselves in now with the twin climate and biodiversity crisis, and they need updated to strengthen this plan and support planners in delivering it. Thank you.
Thanks for that. Yes, we've got a lot of work cut out. Christina, would you like to come in, and then Claire?
Thank you, that's appreciated. So I think just to go back to Barbara's point, you know, that strong thread that is needed throughout everything will help with any confusion. And I think it's that clarity in the documentation that exists across the board, from historic assets to green energy, are actually linked, so you can see that bigger picture. I think that's a really big part of it, because the document's covering a huge amount of ground. And I think, you know, everything can't sit in one place. There needs to be that hierarchy. But when you have that hierarchy, something needs to have sufficient weight attached to it. So there needs to be a primacy within these that's, you know, helping people to understand where the priorities lie. And I think that's a really key thing, to be able to read this document. And alongside that, you know, there's the mention of quality throughout a few policies. You know, what is quality? What does that look like? You know, actually, there could be examples of best practice that, as this is rolled out, because it's a long term strategy, it's there's slight flexibility in it. It can be updated to guide people on what that best practice is, what the post occupancy is, why is it best practice, so that can there can be a level of explanation that helps to support you know, any queries or any confusion about what something might be, and that could be added to over time. But again, that strong thread, you know, that digital support to hang everything together, what Barbara said, you know, that is really key. But it comes down to what are the important principles, what's taking primacy and running throughout is really important.
Thanks. And Claire.
Thank you. Yes, I guess we have a concern, you know, we're talking about the primacy of policies and policies in the round and how we decide which ones are more important. But it feels like that the housing land policies seem to have been developed in a bit of a climate vacuum. You know, land is a limited resource, and if you care about limited resources, you need to be efficient. And it's very crucial then that, you know, we build new housing as efficiently as possible. And I'm pleased to hear that other people's comments about, you know, existing buildings, and, you know, maybe we need to be looking at that to resource our housing crisis. But, you know, at the moment, the way, you know, the housing is being done is very inefficient, and relies on a really generous allocation of land supply to meet housing targets, and that doesn't allow you to target where the infrastructure is going. We're talking about infrastructure first. Well, how can you target that if you've got such generous allowances for land as we've got in this suggested in this document and the annexes? You know, we think that the generosity of the MATLA, the minimum all-tenure housing land requirement, won't encourage efficient delivery. You know, when people move into a new build house, more than half the lifetime emissions of the building have already been emitted. So we need to think about this in terms of climate. And moving on to the shoulds and the musts that were mentioned by Fiona Simpson in her evidence last week, where she said that, you know, that where the word must has been used, where there's a statutory requirement, where it's a policy or practice, they've tended to use should. And this has come up an awful lot when we've been talking to communities and when we're talking about providing clarity. That was a useful comment that Fiona made about why they've chosen that language, but then that needs to follow through, because there's things like the climate and biodiversity policies contain a lot of shoulds, but there are legislative duties on both. For example, the duty on every public office, public body and office holder to further the conservation of biodiversity when exercising their functions is part of the Nature Conservation Act 2004. So that sort of implies that maybe the language should be around must in the document, and that confuses people, I think. So you know, maybe that language needs to be tightened up a bit.
Thanks, Claire. Miles, do you still have more questions you wanted to ask?
No, I think they've all been covered. So happy to.
Great, thank you. All right, we're going to move on to questions from Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. I wanted to come back to an issue that Robbie Calvert touched on in answer to the opening question, and that is around a funding document to support some of the excellent aims and principles in NPF4. Now, to see some of those realised, some submissions have suggested that the NPF4 document should be supplemented by a capital investment programme. I just wanted to perhaps start with Robbie and then go around the rest of the panel to see if they would support that inclusion and essentially the necessity of that.
Thank you.
Yeah, Robbie first. Absolutely. I mean, to deliver a lot of the intentions, even if you think about, for example, the national developments within this plan, how are they going to get delivered? Where's the money coming from that? The infrastructure investment plan or the programme for, I think the infrastructure investment plan only had three of the national developments within that, and none of the national developments were mentioned in the programme for government. So I guess we're concerned where is the investment going to come to help actually deliver these things. So a capital investment programme from that perspective would be useful. But yes, absolutely, in terms of understanding what kind of resource will be required by the planning system to deliver the intentions of this framework and other things in the Planning Act as well. So, for example, local place plans. I think going back to the sort of community engagement question earlier, there is a strong policy steer under policy four for community engagement, but quality community engagement is resource intensive. And unless planning departments get the resource they require, it won't be undertaken to the level that it could be otherwise. So yeah, we'd entirely support capital investment programme, which looks at resourcing in the round in terms of capacity required, in terms of skills required, and in terms of bringing on enough planners to actually process these planning applications when they come through the system.
Thanks for that. Does anyone else want to come in on this? No indication, Mark.
I think I've got Claire and then Barbara in the chat.
All right. Box.
Hello, sorry, I'm unmuted. I just wanted to talk about public-led planning because, I think, I was talking about land being a limited resource and targeting housing in the right places. I think public-led planning is the way to go on that. And so we really agree with what the Scottish Land Commission and others have stated, that, the challenge to achieving the affordable housing aims that we have is to move away from a market-led system to a more public interest-led model of housing development. And this is only really mentioned as a footnote in the delivery section, but it's absolutely crucial and that is properly funded. And I think it's about 300 million or something that is being already given to affordable housing. But I think, in terms of if we're really going to get affordable housing delivery, then we need to do this through the public-led planning mechanism. And that needs to be adequately funded.
Thanks, Claire. I'm just going to come in with a supplement on that. Sorry, Mark, to jump in, but because you've mentioned, both mentioned community investment, I wondered about, we were with a group called Celebrate Kilmarnock yesterday, taking evidence and learning a lot about their experience. And something that came up was about the local authority processes and, kind of a request for them to be improved in a way to accommodate community involvement. Just for example, things like consultation fatigue, because people get really involved, really engaged, really excited, and it takes quite a long time for then the results to come through. So just a question around, how can we improve the community process with local authorities? Claire.
I think what we need is that kind of structure and the culture of community engagement. I think we look to the local governance review coming up that might be able to assist with this, setting a framework and a culture where people are involved better. We in our evidence, I think we suggested public interest panels as a way of sort of involving people in planning decisions in a way where you have a sort of deliberative debate about it and a meaningful debate. And that makes a change from doing vast amounts of written consultations, because not everybody has the capacity just look at what people are expected to read through this national planning framework. If you're not you know, you're a busy nurse or something, you know, what, how are you going to find that time, you know? And we've got a, actually we've got a nurse at the moment that's come to us, you know, she's got four applications for housing developments to get through, and they are coming again and again and being changed, and she's writing to us saying, oh, but it's changed again, do I have to comment again? It's incredibly time consuming, and this, and you don't know for what. What's going to change? You just there's no guarantee, and to boot, you will be labelled as a NIMBY. So I think we've got to get rid of this culture. And when we're talking about community wealth building, you know, what about the public community partnerships that could be developed to maybe sort of deliver better housing through you know, community wealth building model as well? And I think that. That is a section that could be really developed a lot more. Again, it's a little bit minimal, but I understand that that's kind of an evolving thing. But that could be very exciting if the willingness is there to work with communities rather than just seeing them as somebody who's got to respond to a consultation.
Thanks, Claire. And I would see that Barbara and Christina want to come up these questions. And then Mark, I'll come back to you for your next question.
Thanks. I just wanted to say that PAS is part of the key work of PAS is in supporting communities in community-led plans, and we've been involved in lots of different ranges of plans, some of them very focused on things like active travel, some of them broader, and it takes a lot of effort to build that community understanding of what's possible, the system connecting them to people. We get a lot of local authority support in that. They want to help communities, but it comes down to resources again. There's a need, as was said in previous evidence sessions, about joining things together. So this is not just a planning thing. This is planning, housing, transport, environmental health, all of the parts of a local authority. So that place-based approach that's in NPF4 needs to be seen by every part of Scottish government and local government as being their responsibility to support delivery of. But I also think a key thing is, and I take Claire's point about consultation fatigue, but when things start to happen on the ground, then that makes a real difference. So, for example, we were involved in an Applecross community land use plan, and they're starting to see things happen, including provision of sites for affordable housing. So that then gives the impetus for the community to continue to be involved. It's when something is simply a piece of paper that doesn't do anything that you'll get frustration, lack of engagement, and that falling off of trust.
Thanks for that. I know all about the app. It's fantastic. Christina.
Thank you. It was just to go back to the very first part of the question, and I think, you know, we would strongly support the strengthening of the kind of regulatory role of planning and kind of setting that capital investment programme and funding to achieve really well-informed decisions, you know, as the outcome that we're looking for to kind of support a very thorough process. And on the second aspect, in terms of community, I mean, there's great work happening, but we have to be very clear. The majority of stuff that's built is making assumptions about how people want to live and how we want to use the space. The more inclusive we can make and empowering that community involvement can be, it's so important. And that's about making sure the communities are supported in that. Access to professionals and sufficient guidance is really key to that. And I mean, RIS members are very well placed to do that. A lot of members are already involved in that level of engagement, which is fantastic, but it's about making that mainstream. And also I think that helps with that fatigue that can occur, that if you go to a lot of meetings and you don't see a lot of progress, but the more inclusive that process can be, and you see even incremental advancement of things that you want, whether it's a planter, whether it's a slight change to infrastructure or active travel, that doesn't necessarily have to be a big new housing development. I think all of those things add up. So it's about supporting it at both ends. So I suppose when we're looking at that capital investment programme, it's not just about the planning aspect, but taking it right down to grassroots as well.
Thanks very much. So I'm going to move on and come back to Mark. He's got another question to ask. Just in the interest of time, I'm going to be a little bit more, maybe just a couple of people coming in on some of the questions, unless there's really, really something burning that we absolutely need to hear. So, Mark, back to you.
Yeah, thanks, Kavina. We're talking about investment and implementation of the strategy policies and housing targets. Now, this document is going to be in place for 10 years as opposed to normal practice, which has been a 5-year national planning framework. So how do you think in that context implementation and delivery can best be monitored and reviewed over that decade-long plan?
Anybody want to pick up that question about monitoring and reviewing? Robbie and Christina.
Thank you, convener. We'll see how the monitoring programme forms, assuming that will be published alongside the delivery plan. And I know there is provisions within the Planning Act to make amendments to the MPF4, but also within the local development plan regulations for your local development plan if a significant change occurs. So I think there is room to review things like housing numbers if there is a big shock to the system going forward. But I think it's always that balance between flexibility and certainty as well. So ensuring that you have a 10-year housing land supply. I think there is mechanisms in place throughout this plan in terms of identifying short, medium and long-term housing land supply. So I think the right checks and balances are in place for different scenarios going into the future. Thank you.
Thanks. And Christina.
Thank you. It was just to kind of pull in that community aspect as well. So in terms of that 10-year delivery, it's to ensure that those feedback loops aren't necessarily financial, but they spread across kind of life cycle assessments, post-occupancy evaluations, and that understanding of space using different metrics to just finance or, you know, housing numbers, etc., just to make sure it's a holistic approach. So that feedback might need flexibility in the document because some things might not be successful. They might not be rolling out in the way. And if you are tied to something for a long term, it needs to have that flexibility. So again, just kind of what Robbie said, it's that balance of flexibility, you know, versus that kind of long term planning. But it's just to make sure it spreads across a range of metrics.
Thanks very much for that point. I'm going to move on to questions from Eleanor Whittam.
Thanks very much, convener. And before I ask my questions, I'll just refer everybody to my register of interest. I'm still Devon councillor at East Ayrshire Council. So I would like to direct my first question to Robbie, if I could, because you're the first person who mentioned it this morning, although it has already been mentioned several times. And that's round about, you know, written submissions have raised concern about the wording of national planning policy. So we think about things mentioned already about 20-minute neighbourhoods, community wealth building, carbon emissions, and indeed human rights. Now, I brought this up last week with the chief planner. So I want to kind of explore is it insufficiently clear for decision-making purposes? And how can the wording be improved? Because we've already heard this morning that it could lead to appeals, it could lead to, you know, a very interpretive-based type of system. Do you have any suggestions, any kind of concrete thinking round about how that could be improved? And I direct that to Robbie first, please. Thanks.
Thanks for the question. Happy to look at both community wealth building and human rights policies. In terms of community wealth buildings, I think that's quite a difficult one. In my past, I've been a development management planner, and again, as part of the statutory development plan, decisions will have to be made in accordance with the policies within this. And so when I first read it, I thought, well, if I get an application, how can I make a decision based upon what's within the policy? And I have to say, I did struggle with this policy. It refers to having to ensure that applications are in accordance with the community wealth building objectives, but those objectives are not set out anywhere. And digging around a little bit online in terms of literature that's out there, I did manage to find some principles behind community wealth building, but some of those were quite difficult in terms of how could I actually assess a planning application based on them, even though the intent is very laudable. So for example, deciding an application based on the grounds of fair employment and just labour markets might be quite difficult. So I think in our response, we said that maybe this one, this policy needs to be more about aligning local development planning with community and wealth building strategies that local authorities are to produce. And that would be a more effective way to line things up, as opposed to having development management planners decide based on that. And then similarly, moving on to policy four, which is the human rights one, this might get complicated as well, considering other legislative regimes. So, for example, the Human Rights Act 1998 and the Public Sector Equality Act as well. So we've certainly asked for additional guidance on the matter to help make lives easier for development management planners. I'll stop there.
That's great. Thanks very much for that, Robbie. My next question is actually going to be to Christina, because she's raised the issues already. And it's kind of exploring that tension that we've got between existing buildings and places, particularly the need to protect the historic built environment, whilst also allowing the adaptation necessary to reduce carbon emissions. Do you think that the draft NPF 4 pays sufficient attention to this tension between the two competing issues? And Christine, if you could come in on that, that would be great. Thanks.
Thank you for the question. And yeah, it's a difficult one to answer, because it's a difficult problem that we have. And I think it's about, you know, it's also what does heritage mean? And I think often heritage and our listed stock gets separated very distinctively from our existing buildings, and also the kind of the contribution they have to our communities and also to our carbon emissions going forward if they were to be demolished, for example. So I think there's often a real split in approach to heritage and existing buildings, and of course there are differences, but I think it's quite important that the quality aspects or the kind of focus that's given to each category is slightly tangible in terms of actually our existing building stock could have huge value towards a community, for example, and heritage buildings contribute to that further. So it's just about understanding how all existing buildings work. But that tension in terms of adaptation, you know, the difficulty is that every building is different. And that how it needs to be approached is different. What a community feels about that building can be different. So I think that nuance of almost a building for building approach becomes complex when you have a document like this, which is trying to take overarching principles. So I think it comes down to that thread through the documentation on how everything is assessed and how those links provide or make a provision for buildings to be looked at on quite an individual basis if required. And there's a really kind of key, there's a lot of documents that Ailsa mentioned actually, just in terms of if they were linked to NPF 4 around heritage buildings, would really help to support that aspect. I'm happy to go into further detail on that if you wish, but we'll also be submitting a detailed submission later on where we go into all of those nuances. But I think there are documents that could help to support that heritage side. Ailsa may want to come in and speak a little bit more about that as well. But in terms of the tension for adaptation, I think that exists across the existing building and heritage, but it's on a building by building basis generally, which is very tricky. With regards to adaptation of our existing buildings, it's absolutely key in terms of, you know, the standard has been set in terms of net zero emissions. Existing buildings often and heritage can't achieve that, you know, with a kind of technology based approach. It needs to be a fabric. So, how do we address that? How do we take that forward? How do we just embrace that challenge, really, which I think is quite the scary thing to do. But the difficulty is that with heritage, it needs to be very, very carefully done and on a building by building basis, which is a very different scale to what we're talking about on a policy scale with NPF 4. So I think that's the tension. But again, the structure and the opportunity is there throughout the hierarchy to join those dots, as we've spoken about, with policies that already exist that can help to support or that may need to be slightly changed to help support NPF 4.
Thanks very much for that, Christina. And I can see that Ailsa and Claire would like to come in. So I'll take Ailsa first, and if you could add bits into it, because we're kind of only at halfway through our questions, so that would be great. Thanks, Ailsa.
Absolutely, many thanks. I'll be very brief. I would say I would back up the fact that, as I've mentioned, our homes and our housing are part of essential infrastructure, And if they're viewed that way from a policy perspective, then the aspects for maintenance and a fabric first approach can be brought through that policy. Regarding heritage more specifically, BEFS would obviously support appropriate adaptation, and it is on a case-by-case basis quite often managing change guidance from Historic Environment Scotland, again, when appropriately referenced, absolutely helps to make sure that those changes can be appropriate, helping to meet net zero. Very specifically, my final point on this would be in Policy 28, Part D, we've made a suggestion that this policy appears to say, and to put it quite colloquially, no and. And we would, in fact, like maybe the nuance of language to be around yes, but. So it's a case of yes, you can appropriately adapt and change the historic environment and our existing buildings to help meet housing needs, local need, community need. And there are, you know, appropriate considerations to be made, but it should absolutely be a case of these buildings are there to be used. They're a resource that we need to harness. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. That's a really interesting point you made there. I think that's something we need to take on board. And Claire, if you've got a thought on this before I move to my last question, thanks.
I think what I was going to say has been covered, so I'll pass.
Okay, that's great. Thank you. I'm actually just going to come back to you, though, because my last question, I want to direct it to yourself, Claire. And it is round about the minimum all-tenure housing land requirements as set out in the draft NPF4. Which is, you know, set out to try and support a consistent, simpler and transparent system planning for housing. And I know that yourselves, you've already submitted thoughts around about this, and you've touched on it this morning. But do you think there's any changes that need to change to achieve the aims of the simplicity, consistency and transparency in terms of housing land requirement? Just your thoughts on that would be great. Thanks.
Yes, thank you for that question. We did cover MATLA quite a lot. So MATLA being the minimum all tenure housing land requirement. It's interesting, isn't it, when we're talking about communities and how so many communities have come to us about this housing issue and the amount of land being used for it. And yet the technicalities around it has been difficult to get our heads around, but we have. We've looked at how it's been calculated, which is a several stage process that's been done with local authorities, and rightly so. But the initial figures, they've been taken from the housing needs and demand assessment, so people need to look at that, and also the household projections estimated by the National Records for Scotland, so people also need to be aware of that. And this HNDA process, it's supposed to be factual, but, it's clearly influenced by the data used and the subsequent policy and political aspirations applied to it. And the NRS, the National Records for Scotland population projections, they're very much reliant on previous past trends. The data is only as good as the latest situation. So we don't know about the Brexit and COVID updates, for example, on the population figures. So, we've got all that initial data, and then there's several uplifts that occur, and you have to find out about those uplifts from the various annexes in the technical consultation on the housing. And these uplifts that are given, whether local authorities have argued that they've got a greater housing need, perhaps because, there's a homelessness issue, or which is fair enough, or others like Aberdeen City have used a high migration scenario. So they're saying, we're expecting lots of people to move to Aberdeen City. So they've asked for their projections to be increased. And any negative population projections have been asked to be zeroed as well. When people move out of one city, that's not been calculated. It's always an upward lift on these figures. We don't know too much about the demand side of these calculations, whether or not they take into account the demand created by second homes or short-term lets. So complex. But what is perhaps not immediately obvious all these figures are uplifts. And then on top of those uplifts, there's an added flexibility, 25% or 30% flexibility allowance. That is not, we can't find any justification for why it's that amount. You know, people like the Cairngorms National Park asked for a 10% flexibility. They wanted less flexibility on the amount of land that they're using because they said that, you know, the reasons for selecting a 10% flexibility allowance are based on the fact that much of the land in the park is of European and national importance for nature conservation, and most housing sites will have an impact on that, and also the demand for second homes and short-term lets means that a lot of people in the park are not actually living in these houses that are being built. So they wanted less land allocated for housing in this, but that still the uplift was 30%. So this is why, this I've just explained why in our evidence, you know, we've said about this, you know, massive contingency figure. It's quite astonishing contingency figure for the minimum, what is regarded as a minimum all 10-year housing land requirement. And if there's one thing that we would like to see, you know, questioned, is why is it so big? You know, as far as we can see, it's just to pander to the needs of the private sector house building models, business models, which are allowing for their inbuilt inefficiencies. But it's not going to help us to fulfill the legal requirements to set targets for the housing land requirements. I mean, we can do that without adding this massive generosity on. So I think the only justification that we can see is that it kowtowing to pressure from the housing builders to allow them to be inefficient with their processes. One of the real problems we have with policy 9A is that it implies that the MATLA is the housing target. So local authorities are always going to be on the back foot and will face continued pressure to continually release more land as these targets are too big to fulfill straight away. And we think that's going to be a real problem, you know, with planning appeals. And, you know, we're going to see the situation much as we're seeing now, where, you know, developers will be appealing decisions because the because of these unmet targets. So you know, and that and yeah, around not, the, yeah, so
not to cut you off, figure. I can see that Robbie would like to come in on this, and Robbie, if you can come in very briefly and just give us some thoughts, and then I'm going to hand back to the convener. Thanks for that, Claire. Robbie, please.
Thank you. I'll be brief, and even though it is a very complicated matter, we're broadly supportive of this approach taken by Scottish Government for national targets. We hope this moves the conversation on to more about methods of assessing the deliverability of sites and mechanisms to review housing land supply, but most importantly on how we actually deliver quality development as well. Just one thing I wanted to flag is, as Claire's discussed, local authorities have been revising targets, in many circumstances revising them upwards. That is a very resource intensive process, and we believe that there's a big area that the Scottish Government's Digital Planning Task Force should address in terms of data collection as a matter of priority. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Robin. It's really interesting because my own local authority revised their numbers upwards, and that was to do with COVID and migration that we're seeing. And, you know, I think all of those things, the flexibility in that's got to be looked at. So thanks very much, Robbie. And I'll hand back to the convener. Thanks, Ariane.
Thanks very much, Elena. So we have a few more questions from Paul. And I think we've got about 20 minutes. I think we should manage. But yes, if we can keep to the point, I think we'll do a great job. So, Paul, if you'd like to come in with your question.
Yeah, thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. And can I refer everybody to my register of interest, some 7 Council on Easterling Council, just now? A couple of questions for me. The first one was really just talking about resource implications. We heard this morning from a few people talking around about resource implications for planning authorities. And I think, as colleagues have said, we were speaking to Celebrate Romanic yesterday. One of the things that kind of came through was additional resources also for local groups. About how these, you know, how they can develop some ideas that they have, and it's, I suppose, bringing about capacity building. I suppose the first question, I'll probably coming back to Maybe coming back to yourself, Claire, first of all, talking about that, and maybe Barbara after that, just your thoughts on that, because I think we can have the policies in NPF4 to try and help communities and groups, but if they don't have resources to implement these, kind of going nowhere. So I wondered what the views of the panel were on that, if you don't mind. And probably Claire and Barbara, and open it up after that.
Yeah, well, bearing in mind I've just gone on something rotten about the targets, maybe I'll just keep it cool, but it's short. But yeah, very much resourcing for local groups, without a doubt. But also, I think it's about just listening and being willing and open to, you know, it is that culture change that I think that we need to have along with the resourcing. And as I said earlier, you know, putting in the structures that allow regular, you know, where's the databases? Who do you ask if you're talking to a community? You know, we need those sorts of structures in place as a society to, you know, enable a more deliberative democracy, if you like.
Claire, thank you for that. Barbara, I don't know if you want to come in and just touch on that, obviously, with the work that you do.
Yes, thank you. We've been involved with a lot of communities, urban and rural, right across Scotland, and the big thing here is time. It takes time to build that capacity to train locals, even to train local authority staff sometimes to engage effectively with local people because it's not been part of their core work in the past. So there's a big upskilling required both amongst professionals and communities for them to engage effectively in their processes. However, that's not to underplay. If you live in a place, you know it well. You know what the problems are. You know what the good things are about it. Communities aren't stupid. So, you know, we don't need to patronise them. And I think they can decide for themselves. And in fact, many have come to us in the past with very specific asks about what they need. Not every community will need their hand held to the same extent. Some are very able to go off and do their own things. So some of the support will end up being then at the local authority stage where they've developed a plan that then needs the support of everybody in the local authority, their councillors and the staff there, to adopt that plan so that it's given that traction within the system. And I think, again, digital investment could support some of this in terms of showing others what's done. If you go on to the web looking for plans, you know, Google it. There'll be a plethora of websites. I think Scottish Government could really help people navigate the landscape. So can I look at a local place plan that somebody else has produced, see what they've done, so I can get an idea? And there'll be lots of different varieties. So I think there's ways there that we can share good practice and give people the tools to develop their own places.
Yeah, Barbara, thanks for that. I know Christina wants to come in, but just one question, I suppose, to yourself. With the LDB process, I know more local authorities is looking at its LDB process on the back of this. And you know, there's good community consultation in that regard from my own local authority. I don't know what your level of satisfaction is in terms of how other local authorities engage, particularly in about the LDB process, because that's incredibly important when you know that when the local authorities try and look at that. So, is that something you think that's quite well, you know, looked at in across Scotland, or is it mixed or balanced or?
I think it really varies. There are very engaged communities who will influence the local development plan in their place. I think that's particularly true in rural areas. I think it can be really hard for city-based authorities to engage communities who are maybe more transient. You've got a high student population, and you're not maybe getting the range, in particular younger people being involved in local development plans. After all, we're planning for the next generation. And that can be really challenging. Local authorities try all sorts of innovative things. I know people have gone to music festivals, supermarkets, all sorts of venues to try and engage people with it. It's really difficult because, as I said before, this is an abstract concept. So until somebody puts a planning application in your backyard, it isn't real. So I think that, again, that's educating people as to how important this is.
Yeah, Barbara, thanks for that. I know Christina wants to come in and Claire wants to come back in. Christina?
Thank you for that opportunity. I think just to pick up on Barbara's comment, it's those unheard voices in communities which are really key. And although consultation at the moment, it can be very good, it's not often as inclusive as it can be. And I think there's an opportunity through this to reach those unheard voices and the communities that maybe don't have skills within them necessarily, or feel that they will benefit from this process because it feels very removed, to actually make it real for them and build that trust, which is another element that Barbara mentioned earlier on. And I think it's easy, transparent access to information is a big part of that. I know the Our Place website's just launched. I think that's a good start with that initiative. But it's about that ownership of place. And there are programmes that are happening across Scotland already that are embedding that trust and that belief in your community. And I think it's actually putting them on a platform and showing that actually this is a shift in approach. And trying, you know, I've never heard about the festivals idea, but, you know, trying various things. But those unheard voices and building that support around this, again, ground up as well as, you know, policy down, is just so important. So just wanted to reinforce that.
No, I think that's vitally important, I think, Christina. Claire, you want to come back in, and I'm going to move on to my question, if that's OK?
Yes, I just very quickly wanted to say, you know, that it is a 10-year plan, and you know, if you're not engaged at the beginning of it, then you kind of miss out for the next few years. So that, you know, the review of them, I think, is a really important thing. And just a word on things like, you know, Schedule 4s and development plan schemes, you know, all these things, you know, people are very confused. You know, why is all my views going into this package called a Schedule 4? Who are the DPEA? You know, that's another organisation I've got to engage with. And development plan scheme, it's a timetable. You know, why do we have to use all these complicated languages? Just small points, really. Crucial.
Yeah, thank you, Claire. Next question, really, and this is probably one to Robbie yourself, first of all, then I'll open it up. We've had some concerns, obviously, expressed about timescales for consulting on draft NPF4, and also we've also got the Parliament and the Scottish Government running concurrent consultations. I don't know, Robbie, if you've got any concerns about that and what implications that has on the stakeholders and the process, then I'll open it up after that. But probably yourself, Robbie, in the first instance.
Yeah, it's particularly difficult time. I think we're all struggling in terms of capacity. There's a number of parts of the Planning Act that are also being implemented. We've got open space strategies, you've got the developing the nature guidance, which is being consulted on as well. We have the consultation out on the draft local development plan regulations as well as onshore wind policy statement and other committees. So there is a lot going on, and it is very difficult in terms of our capacity, and I'm sure many other stakeholders' capacity as well at the moment. I'd agree with that statement.
Okay. Robbie, just on that, I mean, is there a danger then with all these studies and consultations going out together, they're almost, there's no coherent strategy behind all that, if you know what I mean? You know, that you could get some policies impacting on others. Is there a wee bit more? Do we need to stand back a little bit and think, right, okay, what's getting done and at what time, and how does it impact on other consultations, if you like? Does it impact on that, or is it just a resource issue?
I mean, I think it's inevitable that you're going to have a little bit of this happen, and there's definitely something to do in terms of timing and synchronicity between different plans and strategies. You look at the infrastructure investment plan, well, when's that due for renewal? Because that'll be a pretty important document in terms of setting out investment required for things in the draft National Planning Framework 4. That is an issue. I'd certainly recommend the committee put some space in its diary to scrutinise, for example, local development plan draft regulations, because they're a pretty crucial part of this puzzle. And there's a lot that maybe would be in the NPF or Scottish Planning Policy, which is moved into the draft LTB regulations. So they need to be read alongside one another. So I think in that instance, it's important that they are consulted on simultaneously. But certainly a capacity issue there for us, and I'm sure many other stakeholders.
Well, we appreciate that. I don't know if anybody else wants to come in that one. No.
I don't Claire? See anybody, and maybe we
Claire wanted to come in, convener.
Oh, you've got Claire, okay, Claire.
Then I'll
put in our written response to you about the simultaneous parliamentary scrutiny and the public consultation process that finishes on the 31st of March. And I don't know how you are feeling. I mean, it's your scrutiny process, but we just feel that's, you know, you're scrutinising a draft document rather than the finished one. And if it had been NPS3, you would have been doing it on a final document. So we just raised a concern about that and, you know, how you're going to take into account the public's comments on the draft.
Claire, thank you for that. Convener, I think that's me. I'll pass you back for the last question on this panel.
Thank you very much, Paul. And I'm now going to move over to Willie Coffey with your questions.
Thanks very much, Ariane, and good morning again to the panel. I wanted to start on the issue about resourcing that was mentioned a couple of times, and I'll pick on Robbie because you mentioned it a few times yourself. Robbie, we visited Kilmarnock online yesterday, and we heard from local officials and colleagues in the Celebrate Kilmarnock team who have already been doing some great work down there, creating new public spaces for the communities to enjoy and so on. And much of those achievements are contained within NPF4 at the moment, and that's without NPF4 being finalised, obviously. And they achieved that through funding, town centre regeneration funding, for example, and some common good money. So it was just to make the point that we don't always need to have, beside a document like NPF4, a huge, great big capital investment programme. That some of these matters can be achieved and demonstrated in Kilmarnock through other means. It was just to get your view on that, and whether you recognise that there are other means at local authorities and communities' disposal to reach out and to deliver some of these achievements.
Robbie?
That's me off mute. Yeah, absolutely agree with that, Willie. I think there's lots of great work that's already been undertaken and has been for many years now. And I think this goes back to the point I was making about complementarity there. And it's something we certainly said in our submission, is we were trying to make sure that clear links were made to existing sort of funding packages that are out there, for example, city region deals. But yeah, town centre transformation and plans. But I also think going forward, the National Economic Transformation Strategy will be a particularly important document. So I want to see how that is clearly aligned with the draft NPF4. So planners, I think they can very much sit as the kind of regulatory catalyst for various funding streams and pull them together and to intervene in a sort of place-based sense. I think it's also good to see inclusion of the place principle. I think others have said that earlier, but I think that'll be critical to improving places. Yes, planning is important, but many other parts of local authorities have a part to play as well. Something we've said about the place principle is, though, we think that needs to be something that is very transparent in how it affects the decision-making process, and one that can be enforced. So you can imagine something along the lines of the town centre first principle, but one that's actually an enforceable method of decision making in local government, to secure that kind of place based approach to directing investment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks for that, Robbie. Another issue that came up yesterday in the discussion, we heard about the difficulties that towns like Kilmarnock, and just about any town in Scotland really, have in dealing with empty derelict shops and buildings and abandoned pieces of land within the urban setting. And maybe direct this question to Barbara if I can. Many of these buildings and shops and so on, they're in private ownership, Barbara. And my constituents say to me, why should public money be spent on rescuing a lot of these properties that are deliberately being left in a near abandoned and ruined state that blight our town centres? And if we're serious about the NPF4 allowing us to turn this aspect round, there needs to also be a role for the private sector in making a contribution to this whole strategy. Is that something that you recognise and would you agree with?
Absolutely. And there's a little bit of carrot and stick required here. If it's all stick, then that's no good either. So there's always a call for enforcement and notices and things like that, but that just gets people's backs up. I've seen through previous work that actually engaging with the community, and that's the business community as well. We sometimes forget about that and we focus on residents, but engaging the business community on the influence that they can have on their place. And when you start to see things happening, for example, in my previous job, we provided support to Campbelltown for a town centre scheme. And there were grants given to people to do up buildings. And obviously those were the willing few. But when others started to see what was happening and how it was improving their footfall, it was improving their look, they started to do it too. So I think there is that carrot element as well. If we can start to make some things happen on the ground and we can see a sort of a groundswell, then you will encourage people to view what they've got as an asset, not a liability. And I think that's absolutely critical, because generally, if it's just about dereliction, then it's all negative. So we've got to turn this into a positive and make our town centres more flexible and allow people to do things with them.
Mm-hmm. How do we reach out to the private sector to get them on board with the plan, do you think? I don't imagine they're sitting at the moment reading NPF4. How do we get them round the table and involved and making a contribution, actually? How best can we do that, do you think?
Well, there's lots of forums where businesses are involved with their towns. And I think this is one of these things about maybe a more Team Scotland approach to planning. Mm-hmm. Planning isn't just what planners do. It all happens in a place. So it's engaging those business community organisations as well, and encouraging. And this is one of the things that's fantastic about the parliamentary scrutiny process. This is a Scotland-wide document, and it's for everybody to contribute to its implementation. I think that message needs to get out, that this is not just about engaging residents who don't want to see housing developments. It's actually about engaging all sectors of Scotland's community to make our places better.
Mm-hmm. Lovely, thank you. A third issue that came up, I'll probably try Christina Ariosa on this one. In developing the local plans, we heard from East Ayrshire's officials yesterday about the difficulties they face in reusing some of the brownfield sites that are, again, within the urban setting, probably close to rivers, and consequent objections that we get from SEPA and others about that kind of development and the flood risk issue. Now, I think it was Christina that gave us some statistics earlier about 85% of the buildings will still be there in 2045. I'm prepared to bet that 100% of Scotland's towns and villages will still be beside the rivers in 2045. How on earth do we tackle this? Do we just continue to reject town centre developments that could really help achieve these aims that are set out in NPF4 because of the flooding risk issue? Or is there a better way that we can try to tackle this in the medium short term? By Ilza and Christina, perhaps.
Thank you very much. Well, one of the things that I think is obviously about how we incentivize the reuse of our places is very much about the embodied energy within them, and sort of the fact that these sites can very much have a carbon benefit rather than what can sometimes be described as a heritage deficit. And points mentioned earlier around highlighting the need for maintenance, and that being part of a longer term strategy for our places, and that being built in from the beginning of the process onwards. Obviously, the policies coming into place around vacant and derelict land will help. Policies around densification, again, also help. Points that have been raised by BEFS members have also included that the changes that can happen within town centres, that currently there are concerns around a lack of amenity space in the transition between perhaps some areas becoming housing. And actually, those are policies where housing exists already. There is often potentially a lack of amenity space, but actually that transition and densification could more usefully be supported through policy. Also within Part M of Policy 28, there's intent around using the Buildings at Risk Register to help inform and guide decision making, again, to help the reuse of buildings. There are some concerns that you want to be able to focus on a range of buildings, not just the buildings at risk. It's good to see it mentioned, but the intent of that policy perhaps could be broader. I understand the concerns from SEPA, but I'll say that's not an area where we've had particular comment from members. So I wouldn't want to take away from sort of SEPA's specialist knowledge, but I will say that sort of in ensuring that balance between sort of useful floodplains, but maybe putting the densification elsewhere and incentivizing that use of brownfield land where possible is absolutely essential to our places. Thank you.
Okay. Just lastly, Christina, since I name checked you, I mean, what can we possibly do about this? We can't leave our town centres, the brownfield sites in particular, that might be due for rivers. We can't just leave them because we think they might flood from now on. We have to do something more about it. What do you think? What can you suggest that we could do to tackle that?
Well, I mean, I think it's a really interesting problem, and part of the RIS strategy for COP26 was looking at flooding, you know, inland as well as coastal. So I feel like maybe you saw that, but I think it's about understanding the sites. It's definitely prioritising the protection of existing green space, views, daylight, amenity opportunities, you know, encouraging net gain principles, avoiding offsetting in that response, which means brownfield sites, the value, you know, changes because actually that's where development is well placed. But as you say, there are many issues with this. Sometimes it's not just seeper and flooding, other things. But I think it's about understanding the sites before they move forward. It's about working with seeper. It's about a different design approach. We're talking about MPF4 as a shift. You know, design architecture is shifting as well. We've got to learn to adapt to deal with these sites to maximise their capacity and also to free up that amenity and that protection of green space. They go hand in hand, but I think it's a challenge again for the whole industry, and it's setting those targets to make sure that actually that's what we're focusing on, that's what we're working towards, that's where the changes are happening. And I think, you know, there is a huge amount of expertise in CEPA and other organisations that are looking at these sites, but that's a design challenge. I mean, that's what architects love. So I'm coming at this from a different perspective a little bit. But, you know, that's a challenge that we've got to address and face. But it's not just for one person to solve. It's that kind of teamwork aspect in terms of we've got to use this opportunity. How do we do it? And, you know, we'd be happy to be involved in those discussions. But it's definitely one of those challenges we've got to overcome. And just to pick up on your previous point very quickly, there is the opportunity for... let me just get my terminology right here, to bring together kind of public and private sector, is the Scottish Council for Development and Industry, to make sure there's that bridge between residential and private ownership as well and businesses, just to pick up on your last point.
Thanks very much for that, Christina. That's very helpful. Thank you all. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Willie, for your questions. And that concludes all of our questions, and I think we've done a very good job covering a lot of good ground, and you've all brought very important comments and responses to what we've been asking. I think it's been a very helpful morning. So I just want to say thanks for joining us and giving up your time today, and I'm now going to suspend the meeting to allow for a change of our witnesses. Welcome back. We are going to continue taking evidence as part of our budgets, a part of the scrutiny of the MPF4, and I would like to welcome our second panel this morning, Dr. Caroline Brown, who's a lecturer in environmental planning and healthy environments at Heriot Watt University, Professor Cliff Haig, who's Emeritus Professor of Planning and Spatial Development, also at Heriot Watt University, and he's also the chair of the Cockburn Association. And also, I'd like to welcome Professor Lee Sparks, who is the Deputy Principal and Professor of Retail Studies at the Institute for Retail Studies at Stirling, the University of Stirling. So thank you so much for joining us today. And we've already had a very rich session with the previous panel, and I'm looking forward to what we hear from you. We're going to move straight to questions. What we tend to do is try to direct our questions to one person initially, but if you want to come in on something, please put an R in the chat box. And if we start to run out of time, you might be asked to just come very quickly to a point, just so that we make sure that all the questions get answered. So I would like to direct, I'm going to kick off with the first question, and I'd like to direct that to Dr. Caroline Brown first. It's Caroline, the draft MPF4 represents a significant shift in planning policy with a new focus on issues of place, livability, well-being and emissions reduction. And I'd like to hear if you think the Scottish planning system will be able to deliver these ambitious outcomes.
Thanks. Yes, as before, I think a really interesting question to begin with. The shift in focus is really significant, and that will create a challenge. It'll create a challenge for the planners working within the system, but also the others that work in development, that's house builders and developers and architects and things, to understand and interpret the policies and the principles behind them. And I think we've already heard from others about clarity about language and definitions, and I think from my perspective, there are certainly some elements of the NPF4, while welcome, that need to be fleshed out in order to provide clarity. And the reason this is important is because in a discretionary system where planning officers and developers and others are talking about what should and shouldn't happen in the future, any doubt or any terminology which is not crystal clear allows developers, particularly in a system which is struggling for resources, to push against the requirements and to diminish what they deliver. Now, there are many developers who are very ambitious about what they're doing and want to go further than policy and are ahead in some ways of some of these ideas, but there are also many that are well behind the curve, and we have to bring the unwilling along with us. So clarifying these terms is really important to help planners deliver this on the ground in a system that's currently under-resourced. It's really important because the time for those conversations is limited. With more planners, it's easier, but with few planners, it's really hard to make these things stick with developers when you're saying biodiversity is important, climate's important, health and well-being are important. Your scheme at the moment doesn't deliver on these things. We need more and more of this. But if we have clarity about what we're expecting, it makes it much easier to deliver for everyone.
Thank you. Thank you for that. That was very clear. Thank you so much for that. I'd like to bring in Cliff on the same question.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with what Caroline's saying and with what much of what was said in the earlier session this morning. The only points I think I would add is that the less the clarity in a system, the more that favours those with deep pockets. So it's not just a matter of clarity for clarity's sake. There is an equity issue here. And I think the presentation from Claire in the earlier session about the housing need and demand analysis really shows that the more complex it gets, the more impossible it is for any kind of grassroots involvement to actually be meaningful. So I think clarity and simplicity desirable. And I think they would also go some way to freeing up some of the existing human resources that are there in the planning system. The complexity, the focus on development management tends to mean that staff are very, very pressed, and accept that totally. But if we could actually make the system simpler and clearer, with less recourse to these special pleadings and you know, particularly planning appeals, then you could actually use that existing resource more effectively. Having said that, I think to engage with the issues that have come forward, particularly the issue of circular economy and the issue of community wealth building, then there also needs to be an investment in skills development in those areas to make the system effective in dealing with them. And I think that Robbie's comments earlier on, where he basically said he didn't really know much about community wealth building, were quite indicative of that. It's not a criticism of Robbie. I think he's probably reflecting quite a widely held view. But there is a literature out there. There are practice examples. And some things become very simple. Again, going back to the housing flexibility issue, that is clearly undermining a notion of community wealth building. It's actually taking wealth out of the community by adding to the value of land, which is increasingly through developers and people who fund developers, going into the pockets of investment trusts and hedge funds. So far from benefiting the local economy and recycling the material within that economy, it's actually extractive. I could say a lot more, but I'm sure other people want to come in.
Thank you very much for that. That was really insightful, and actually you kind of like, you just put in a few bits of the jigsaw puzzle for me of things I've been wondering about. I mean, actually, just, you know, you talk about planning departments being pressed, and some of it is to do with the recourse for appeals. I mean, why do we have this appeal system? You know, the developers can put through planning application that gets refused, and then they can take it to appeal. And then that's putting, you know, what you're talking about is that then stretches a planning department if they're constantly having to do that.
Well, I used to give 1 hour lectures, so I'll try and contain myself. It goes back to the way the 1947 system was set up and the lobbying of landowners at that stage. But essentially, if you look internationally, not all systems have many systems have some right of a disappointed applicant to appeal, but not that many of them have the kind of extensive system UK has. For example, much of Scandinavia, the appeal will actually go back to the local planning authority rather than to this much more kind of quasi-legal process and centralised decisions. So basically, yeah, it reflects a balance of interest within the system. And of course, there was extensive discussion about this when the 2019 Act was being taken through Parliament. And the decision basically of the Parliament was to retain that sort of system.
Thank you for that. And thanks for keeping it brief. I was digressing a little bit, but I do think it touches in on the point that I keep hearing that planning departments are stretched, and it's kind of looking for, you know, where are the opportunities to put some ease into the system? I'm going to move on, and I'd like to bring in Mark Griffin, who has a question for the panel.
Thank you, Camina. Just to ask members of the panel whether they think that the policy priorities set out in the draft plan align with other government strategies and investment priorities, and do you think that the draft plan would benefit from having its own capital investment programme to make sure that we see some of those ambitions delivered? Perhaps bring in Lee, if you wanted to come in, since you've not had a chance to contribute so far.
Thank you. I'm not sure I'm the best person to actually address that. I can take the alignment point, first of all. I think in terms of alignment, there is alignment there, but I think it could be clarified rather more than it is at the moment. And I also think it's important that other policies that are emerging do take the right alignment with MPF4 as it develops. And I think there is more work to be done in government around that on both sides. On the capital elements around that, I think from the bits I know about it, I think there are funds available. There will be more funds. Place-based investment program, I think. I'm not sure I would add anything in terms of additional funds. I think complicating the landscape with lots of little funds doesn't necessarily help us that much.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Dr.
Brown. I see that Caroline Brown would like to come in.
Thanks. I agree with many of the things that Robbie Calvert said earlier about this, that it's really important that there is some clarity about how the Scottish Government intends to implement this and where necessary, particularly on the national projects that are outlined in draft NPF4, that there is some clarity about where the resources are going to come from. I note that NPF4, the draft, talks about an infrastructure levy, and I think this is an important potential component. If there is an infrastructure levy going forward, that is the sort of thing that may be used to help deliver an infrastructure first approach. Now, my understanding of infrastructure first does not necessarily align with what's in the draft plan as it stands, which is about understanding infrastructure needs before you do things rather than delivering infrastructure before you do things. And I think that's an important, it was something that jumped out when I read the draft. Oh, infrastructure first. I'm definitely up for that, but I'm not sure how the way it's written is quite how I would put it. But in order to deliver infrastructure first, we need to have some funds, some capital funds to do that. And we need to define what we mean by infrastructure, because this doesn't define it. So are we talking only about roads, which is what most people think of first, or are we also talking about schools and healthcare, but also the assets in a community which make it a healthy place to live, which could also be described as infrastructure. So I think it's really important that there is money, there is a plan to deliver this, and if necessary, to bring things together, to bring funds together. I'll stop. There's much more we could talk about on transport, for example, but let's not go there.
Thanks, Caroline. I'm going to bring in Cliff.
Really important question, Mr. Griffin. And you know, everybody talks about integration. All we researchers always say what you need to do for effective policy making is integrate, so that one ministry doesn't undermine the policies of another ministry. In practice, it's very difficult on the ground. And I think what's really going to be necessary is a very close working with across Scottish Government areas. I mean, the planning and health dimensions need to be pulled together. I think it would certainly help if there's budget lines attached to elements of the plan. But again, in terms of infrastructure, I'd echo one of the things that was said earlier this morning, which is most of the infrastructure for 2045 is already there. And a lot of that maintenance money will actually come out of private pockets. What we need is ways of influencing that. In terms of other areas where I think we need to connect, I think the word homelessness does not currently feature in MPF4 draft. Yet Scottish Government has important policies on homelessness. And I can't see really how one can talk about human rights, which include the right to adequate housing, and have a housing section without then having some mention of connection into homelessness policies. So there's a range of things that need to be done. And there's an important message, I think, for politicians and for officers in terms of embedding the aspirations in MPF4 widely across the full range of Scottish Government services.
Okay, thank you. Moving on from funding then to implementation and monitoring, I just wanted to ask panelists their views on, as we move from a 5-year planning framework to a 10-year planning framework, on the importance of monitoring and reviewing implementation of the strategy, policy and housing targets, how best we do that and the importance of it as we move to a 10-year long plan. Professor Haig, if you want to come back in.
I'm old enough to remember the days when there were sort of research and intelligence teams in planning departments in local government. And I think information collection research is really important. Local government is the closest to the action in these things. So I think they need to revive that kind of capacity. In terms of monitoring, I think the big questions are, what are your priorities? And you then focus your monitoring primarily on those priorities. So I think what we tended to do for quite a long time in Scottish planning is have a focus on, if you like, consumer satisfaction surveys. Whereas what we begin to need to see here is how the MPF4 begins to impact upon the circular economy, begins to impact upon the issues around, as I said earlier, the climate emergency, and so on. I think pick out the priorities, get key indicators, and share the monitoring process with local government.
Thank you.
Thanks. I see that Caroline and Lee would like to come in as well on this question, Mark.
Oh, it's me. Thank you. Yes, definitely we need implementation and monitoring to be going on. It has been something that has been stretched within planning as a discipline, as a profession within local government, central government, because of resourcing issues. So I completely support what others have said here. And measuring the outcomes, planning not been very good at reflecting on how well it's performed in the past. And I was wondering to myself yesterday if there was a published evaluation of NPF3 that was available, and I couldn't find one. I don't know if there has been anything like that which has fed into the preparation of this draft. Forgive me if I've missed it. But I think these questions are really important. I don't want to suggest that we should invent a new system for doing this or add burdensome requirements for reporting, but it is really fundamental to knowing whether what we're trying to do is happening and whether this these policies that are in place are delivering for us.
Thank you. And Lee.
Absolutely agree with what's just been said by Cliff and Caroline, but two other points to develop slightly. I think we need to understand, particularly if we are going into some of the areas that are new for us in terms of MPF4, what we actually want to measure and how we measure those, because I don't think we have the right measures at the moment. And I think the way we've done it previously, the way we do it in towns, for example, at the minute, I think is not suitable for the way we need to think about what we're trying to build in terms of places. And secondly, I'd make a bit of a plea that we have some comparability and consistency about how we measure things, and we don't leave it to 20 or 30 different ways of measuring the same thing across different places. I think that is really quite important to understanding how we're making progress.
Okay, thanks,
Lena.
Back to you.
Thanks, Mark. And we're now going to move on to questions from Eleanor Whittam. Eleanor.
Thanks very much, convener. And I would like to direct my first question to Professor Haig, if I can. 20-minute neighbourhoods are mentioned about 34 times in the draft NPF4. Indeed, it's something that's on everybody's lips, it seems, nowadays. And when I was part of the Social Renewal Advisory Board, it was something that was spoken a lot about from lots of different people in lots of different policy areas. What do you think it's going to take to turn this from a policy priority into reality? Thanks.
An action on the ground. I think we need to recognise again that 20-minute neighbourhood doesn't just apply to new development. We need to look at 20-minute neighbourhoods in the context of many of our neighbourhoods, which have seen a diminution of public and private services over the last 10, 20 years. And that becomes quite critical. It's not just a case of doing a nice design for a new edge city development, but also tackling the legacy that we've got, which on the one hand, as again people said earlier this morning, is really crucial in terms of embodied carbon and ensuring that everybody lives in a healthy and attractive environment. But it then needs action on those existing facilities. You know, the youth clubs that have been lost, the shops that have been lost. No doubt Lee can say much more about that than I would. But I think we need to you know, recognise the importance also of transport connectivity between neighbourhoods. You know, where we need the evidence of where are the places where accessibility is actually poor, even if they're actually within an Edinburgh, Glasgow, and Aberdeen and Dundee, even within the big cities. There are some neighbourhoods which are relatively poorly served by basic public transport. So I think we need to back the idea they can link into local place plans. You could see a way that this actually generated the enthusiasm and commitment of people at a local level to taking a greater control of their local neighbourhood. But it does need a clarity of framework, and it does need resourcing at local level. And again, going back to what I said earlier, you know, could we actually shift some of the capacity in planning departments towards working on regenerating existing neighbourhoods rather than dealing with applications for new developments beyond the edge of the city against the development plan, which are really basically a drain on resources of all concerned.
Thanks very much for that. And before I bring Dr. Brown in, I would just like to take you back to the whole concept of community wealth building, which you've already touched on this morning. And how do you see that fitting in with the 20-minute neighbourhoods, that whole concept, keeping that wealth local?
I think what we've seen in a number of neighbourhoods, which I'm sure you're familiar with, is that there's been this combination of disinvestment from the public sector and from the private sector. So you've got to somehow begin to turn that around. I think this is where there has to be connections with the Scottish Land Commission work, which I think is surprisingly underrepresented in MPF4 as it stands. So you have to find ways that you can, using that and the Community Engagement Act, you can actually engagement empowerment, I can't quite remember what it was, but you can actually begin to find different ways, whether it be social enterprises, startups, you know, take advantage of the cheapness and availability potentially of empty property to generate a level of reinvestment at a local level. It'll be different in different areas. There's lots of challenges. You need souls on fire to drive it at a local level. Probably people have got a passionate view, but then you've got to back those people with, sort of startup money, you know, pump priming investment that will actually help pull things together. And a local place plan that had a 20-minute neighbourhood focus, but then was tied in to these other streams of involving, you know, and generating social enterprises, local startups, cultural events, whatever. It will say it will depend on the particular place, but there's a mindset here that says we're really serious about transformation.
Thanks very much for that. And Dr. Brown, if you would like to come in and add a couple of thoughts to that, I can see you want to.
Yeah, no, 20-minute neighbourhoods is really fascinating, and I think there is a significant danger that it could be turn into something that becomes very commercial, so that people feel that if they don't have a Costa or a Starbucks coffee shop within a 5-minute walk, 20-minute neighbourhoods have failed. But as Cliff has just been saying, it needs to be much more rounded, the idea of 20-minute neighbourhoods, so that we're clear that it isn't just about commercial retail opportunity, having a coffee shop nearby. It is also about the other sorts of community uses and social enterprises. So circular economy, to give one. So it's things like having a repair shop nearby, having a tailor or a cobbler, those sorts of things that were very traditional in a 21st century form, but getting those sorts of things into 20-minute into our neighbourhoods would be a way of making 20-minute neighbourhoods happen. And I want to just come back to the point we were just talking about implementation and monitoring. Mixed use development is a long-standing approach within planning, and we have many policies that have attempted to deliver that over the last 2-3 decades. However, there are many examples of how this fails, and we see it. I'm speaking in Edinburgh, and there are many examples of housing-led development, which has retail units within it to meet the requirements of the policy. However, those units remain empty for years in some cases. And sometimes what happens is that they eventually become housing because no business has been taken, has been found to take up the opportunity. So there is something also about linking up business support, community enterprises, social enterprises, and sort of animation of these opportunities. Because the plan, it's very easy to write a policy which says we want mixed use developments and we want to provide retail opportunities and, you know, these other things in neighbourhoods, new and old. But if we can't get people to bring businesses or create businesses to occupy those spaces, then we fail. And that's the big danger. So I think, again, we need to reflect on how well some of those policies have worked in the past and how we might change that so that they do become hubs for local businesses and enterprise, whether those are socially led or commercially led.
That's really great. Dr. Brown, thank you. And it's actually a really good segue into the question I've got for Professor Sparks, who wants to come in. And it's all about the fact that, you know, there's a huge driver behind the NPA, the draft NPA4, about living locally. And just with your expertise round about retail, Professor Sparks, I want you to maybe give us an idea of do you think that as it's set out, it's going to drive that investment in planning locally, or do you still feel as if we're going to end up with out-of-town retail as opposed to in-town retail? So your thoughts on that, Professor Sparks, thanks.
Okay, I'll try and not do the Cliff's 1 hour lecture at this point. As it stands, where would I say there are many good things in the draft NPA? And very supportive of from the new future. Where am I more worried about it? I'm worried about it in terms of the ways, it goes back to the earlier discussion, where I think there are holes and where people will push back in many ways. There's an awful lot of should, and I'd be rather wanting it to be rather more focused and directive. There are words like additional in the town centre first assessment. It talks about no significant adverse effect. I can see us having an entertaining discussion about the word significant. And if we're serious about towns and serious about the state of towns and bringing things into 20-minute neighbourhoods, into town centres, I think we need to be much more focused on saying out-of-town development doesn't exist anymore. We have to reverse it in many ways. And that was the thrust of what we tried to say over a period of time in the new futures developments towns. So I'm pleased the way it's going. I would make a plea for it to be strengthened. Otherwise, I think there will be things and people will continue to try and do things. One of the other panelists said earlier about there are those that are on board in terms of where this is going and not. And it's that latter part I really worry about, that they're still focusing on what is a model that, in all intents and purposes, has been damaging our town centres and damaging our places. And I think I would try and get NPF4 to push rather more strongly to say, we really have got to stop this. And it's stop it, not just should stop it, we must stop it.
Thanks very much, Professor Sparks, for your thoughts there. My final question is actually going to be to Dr. Brown. And it's round about the policies as laid out in the draft NPF4. Do you think that they're going to produce an environment that meets the needs of groups, including children, women, older and disabled people? And if not, what changes would you like to see made? And that's for Dr. Brown. Thanks.
Yes, another 1 hour lecture coming up. I think there are many promising things in the draft NPF. However, I think one of the things that is missing is any mention of those specific groups and their needs. Now, clearly, really hard to summarize, and you know, women are a diverse group, children are a diverse group, and people with disabilities also extremely diverse. But I think it is important to perhaps mention some critical issues which affect those groups and in which they currently are disadvantaged. So just for example, if we talk about active travel and cycling, we know that people who cycle, so more men than cycle than women. And why is that? It's to do with infrastructure. So if we have that as a starting point, that helps us to see what sort of policies we need to put into effect and what sort of designs will help us reduce that inequality. And I think it's the same for children. The place efficiency duty is an amazing step forward, and obviously that sits alongside this. We have good precedent from Wales to look at, and that will really help. But I just think giving planners, giving professionals some pointers about how these groups are disadvantaged and the inequalities they currently face can help us work out what we have to do, rather than we don't mention those groups explicitly in here. We talk about equalities, but if we don't know what the inequalities are, we can't fix them, and we need to say what those inequalities are. I could go on, but I think I should leave it for you.
That's very, very helpful though. Thank you, Dr. Brown. I think it echoes a lot of my own feelings on the issue. I'm going to hand back to the convener now. Thanks, Ariane.
Thanks, Eleanor. And we're now going to move to questions from Paul McClellan.
Thank you, convener. I think we've kind of touched on this before, and this is probably to Professor Haig. It's really around about the policies in the draft NPF4 aimed at protecting our built heritage. But it's about reaching the right balance between preservation and allowing essential action to reduce carbon emissions. I'm just wondering what you have any comments on that, Professor Haig, first of all, and what changes you'd like to see made in that regard?
I think I'd like to see the historic environment bit connected up much more strongly with the overall strategy, not the sort of appendage added on pretty late on, but recognising the multiple benefits of historical buildings, but also our landscapes and our land. You know, this connects to a circular economy. You know, the circular economy idea is that you don't use up finite resources, and land is a finite resource, buildings are finite resources. So we need to see the conservation of the historic environment as part of a much wider conservation focus. If we switch the focus of NPF4 away from how we deal with the increment of development that's going to come between now and 2045, and focused, as I think the woman from RIAS was saying earlier this morning, on the 85% of development that's still going to be there from now, I think that would be more effective. So I think we need the explicit connections to historic environment policy statements, but also a kind of shift around in the focus to actually put the historic environment and the existing environment. We're all in a sense living in a historic environment. You know, it may only be a 10-year-old historic environment, but it's a historic environment nonetheless. And what we do with those places, how we manage them, how we care for them, the assets, and the well-being that they provide to, you know, people of all walks of life across Scotland is really critical. And that's really where we need to see the focus of effort, I think, looking forward.
Yeah, thanks, Professor Haig. And I mean, you'll know obviously with your Coburn Association hat on as well, how relevant that is in Edinburgh and lots of buildings going forward. Can I ask the same question, probably, Dr. Brown, again, your thoughts, and come on to Professor Sparks after that as well, because again, I think part of the issue, Professor Sparks, in terms of that is obviously if we're looking to develop our town centres and so on, and that may be in old historic buildings, but I'll ask Dr. Brown to come in first, and if Professor Sparks wants to comment after that. Dr. Brown?
This is where it gets tricky, isn't it? Because I noticed in, and I can't put my finger on just at the moment, but there's one place where it's talking about, it's on green energy, I think, and talking about, you know, balancing proposals for solar arrays against historic environment things. And this is where it gets hard. And I live in a historic, you know, conservation area in a lovely villa. And if I wanted to put solar panels on my house, you know, which thing is most important? And this is why some of the panelists earlier were talking about, you know, we need to have some clarity about overarching goals. My view as an environmental planner is that in many cases we should put the environmental climate one first over the historic environment one. But I recognise Cliff's elegant point about the circular economy and using finite resources responsibly. But I think this question is a really important one, and it's something to be, there's a lot of nuance here about how we reconcile some of these policy objectives. And we should recognise that some of the things that we do with our historic environment are necessary in order to meet our objectives for 2030 and 2045 carbon reduction. So we have to grapple with some of this detail, and it's gritty and difficult, but that's the task ahead of us, I'm afraid, to do that.
No, thanks, Dr. Brown. I think that you're right. I think you're talking about overarching strategies. Where does that then come into NPF4, and how is that interpreted? You know, and there's that degree of flexibility, I think, and interpretation. I think each local authority might look at it different, you know, and depending on that, that's one for the committee, I think, to grapple. Professor Sparks, I don't know if you want to come in that one as well, you know, in terms of obviously economic development in some of the cities, you know, obviously there may be old buildings that we need to upgrade, for example, but, you know, obviously we've got the impact of possibly essential action to reduce carbon emissions, and that might make the building not viable and so on. So I'm wondering what your thoughts are on that.
A couple of things, if I may. The first is, I think this does vary and by place, and each place is an individual place, and therefore I think that also, that localness is quite important, because it's that localness and distinctiveness that those historic buildings give that actually make that place distinctive. I know the history part in one sense is in that distinctive places in NPF4, it could be in other places, as I said. But there is that feeling that the identity of a place is about what it looks like and what it feels like, and therefore destroying that for whatever reasons isn't necessarily a good thing. I think if we are thinking about things that are livable, that places are attractive, we need to have that element of the historic environment within it. Is it difficult to do things in historic buildings, and more difficult than it is on greenfield sites and elsewhere? Yes, it absolutely is. Is it more expensive to do it? Yes, I think we could alter that by thinking about how we change some of the taxation systems, how we think around aspects of that. But we do need to try and grapple with, we've got these places, we've got these buildings, we've got these centres that people do identify with, and they're underused, and we shouldn't be wasting them. So we do need to find a way of actually making sure we use them better than we have at the moment. But I appreciate the difficulty in. It's easier to say, difficult, more difficult to do.
Yeah, Mr. Sparks, thank you for that. And Convener, if I may, just on that one, I suppose that the supplementary to that then is that to all three, is there a need for clear supplementary guidance from planning authority in that regard, from each local planning authority, and, you know, on top of NPF4? Because I think obviously it's delivering NPF4, but what do we need beyond that? So I don't know if this is Professor Haig or Dr. Brown, in terms of that, do we need clear, I suppose, clear supplementary guidance for each? I mean, I'm thinking Edinburgh, Professor Haig, in terms of, you know, the built environment there. Is there sufficient there just now, or do we need clear supplementary guidance behind that?
I think generally supplementary planning guidance would help, but I just wanted to make another slightly related point, which I think Lee Sparks would probably also echo. I think historic buildings can be particularly significant in smaller towns. I think we've not really discussed the small town Scotland. We've not really discussed the overall spatial strategy very much. But you know, the closure of one significant, whether it be a church, a district court, former bank, whatever, these tend to be imposing buildings in the city centre that give distinctiveness to the place. And it really is very important, I think, that we recognise that unless we can make an impact on the reuse of those buildings, it actually has a detrimental effect upon the vibrancy of the small town itself. So, and small towns are a really significant part of the Scottish urban landscape. So I see that Lee's jumping in on this. I'll happily pass over to him.
Thanks, Professor Hagen. Lee?
Yeah, exactly that. Cliff makes a very good point. And those buildings are distinctive. We have distinctive urban forms within Scotland. And if you take out some of those major buildings, those major historic artifacts, that loses that identity of the place. And that's why these become more important. And it is more important in the smaller towns because they are so significant. And we built that up over a long period of time and we lose it at a real cost. So, yeah, that small town point is a really valuable one.
No, thank you for that. And I think that's something again for the committee to consider. I want to move to another area, and this is about housing. And I suppose it's the policy approach to housing taken in the draft MPF4, and this is including the minimum housing all 10-year land requirement. Will this result in the homes people need being built where there is demand? Dr. Brown, I'll probably come to yourself first of all and open up after that, see if anybody else wants to talk on that one. But yourself first of all, Dr. Brown.
Okay, I am not a housing expert and I have many colleagues who are experts in housing. However, I am a planner and I have a view. There are some useful things in here, but I find it astonishing that the management of short-term lets is not addressed at a strategic level, because short-term lets have in effect taken many homes out of the housing market and put them into the tourism market. And if there was a development for a hotel, we would require it to have planning consent. And instead, short-term lets are allowed to happen without any coherent national level regulation, which I find extraordinary. And I find extraordinary that it is not mentioned here, the significant impact of short-term lets in many housing market areas at local level, including, of course, Edinburgh, but of course also many of our rural communities too, really suffering as a consequence of this. So I don't want to take up time because I'm sure Lee and Cliff will have other things to say, but I find that a particularly extraordinary missing component to the draft as it stands.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Brown. You'll know we've been discussing this topic in committee the last number of weeks, and obviously there's measures that local authorities can take. Professor Haig, Professor Sparks, I don't know if either one of you want to come in and comment on that.
Yeah, I'd echo Caroline's comments. I think we've lost literally thousands of flats that were, broadly speaking, providing affordable accommodation in Edinburgh, particularly in the city centre, which has impacts upon the character of the city centre itself as a living centre, but also in other parts of the city. And you know, we do all this juggling with housing demand numbers, but the impact of the loss of housing to basically you know, commercial renting that's been unregulated. I know there's moves in other areas of Scottish Government to address this. But similarly, I think there is a bit of a sort of naivety, again, or inconsistency. You know, in the housing section, there's endorsement, for example, of build to rent as a kind of innovative form that's a good thing and we're going to back it. A very interesting article in The Observer on Sunday, basically saying that hedge funds across the world are piling into build-to-rent. It's low risk, it's high returns, and it's a long-term guaranteed thing. You know, you couldn't have designed it better if you wanted to actually take money out of a local economy and relocate it to a tax haven. It's ideal. Okay, so we really need to get to grips with these kind of issues, I think, and rethink particularly the housing policy section. It's the section of all the MPF4, I think, that shows most continuity with the past policy and least willingness to actually grapple with the notion that there is a climate emergency, that we are trying to regenerate places, that we are trying to reinvest the assets that are of an area to community benefit rather than see them drain away.
Thanks, Professor Haig. Professor Sparks, I'll bring in. I suppose it's really the question for me is probably a little bit more detail with yourself in terms of obviously town centre first planning. And again, I know there's been the travel direction, certainly from guidance from yourself in terms of making high streets and main streets, you know, mixed use in terms of people actually living on high streets and so on. And, you know, many people want to do that. So again, just coming back to that question, but with your town centre hat on, if you like, you know, what your views on that are.
Yeah, very interesting. Cliff's last final sentence there. My notes in terms of draft MPF4 about housing, I just wrote, meh. I'm really not sure what it actually was delivering. And certainly if we think about what we have to do in terms of the elements you mentioned, Paul, then we, you know, 20-minute neighbourhoods, gentle densification around town centre, building that community around it, builds that core, builds the high street, builds all of the assets in that town centre. And we need to pull that together. When I read the sections on housing, I really didn't get that sense. Now, I'm not a housing expert, so you have to take that in mind. But I really did not get the sense that that was really aligned with what we've been talking about in the other policy directions. That also ties into some of the ownership aspects around community wealth building, as others have just said. So that's where I was probably disappointed in terms of town centres and the link. So I would echo what your comments are about the housing side of it. Needs a bit more work on it and a bit more sense of how we actually break what we know is a problem and use the assets we've got.
Thanks. Thanks, Lee. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you all. Even early, it's very good to hear your perspectives on. They were asking everybody about MAPLR and trying to get our heads around it. I'd like to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the second panel. Professor Sparks touched upon this, but I wanted to ask a question and with regards to the draft MPF 4 being poorly worded. Now, we've got on record what you had to say with that, Professor Sparks, but I wanted to ask, specifically looking at priorities within MPF 4, whether or not you thought language was having an impact on that and whether or not that should be laid out far clearer, for example, with a presumption in favour of renewables within planning departments taking these applications forward. So I just wanted to get the panel's view on that, and specifically where language has already been touched upon can sometimes not have a clear meaning. So I'm happy to bring you back in, Professor Sparks, or if others want to put an R in the chat on that.
Thank you. Yeah, my comments about language really focused around view of the town centre. Sorry, the renewables part, I'm not sure I can comment as much on. I'm very concerned about it's trying to be more balanced than I would be if we're serious about the things we talk about in terms of climate emergency, 20-minute neighbours, community wealth building, all the sort of things we want, the good things around health and wellbeing and all the rest of it. But I think we do need to be rather more prescriptive about these aspects. I go back to my comment, I'm very taken by the Town Centre First Assessment, that point about no significant adverse impact. Well, why are we having any adverse impacts on town centres given where we are? So what's that language and room for argument there? So I go back, I really would like to see a much strengthening of the language right throughout the document in many ways, and certainly in terms of the way the implementation goes. We just had a position in Stirling last week with an out-of-town development being given planning permission, despite the recommendations of the council to reject it. And I just fear we're going to continue to get that because it was around sort of language issues and what we've got there. I also noticed in the glossary, if I've got it right, there's no definitions of out of town, so we've got wriggle room there. And so there's a lot of things around that, and the practicalities I'd like to see strengthened if we could.
Thank you, and Dr. Brown?
This is really important because it affects delivery and implementation where planners are tight for time. Having a definition that's set out is really helpful in the discussion with the developer about what an adverse impact is, what significant emissions means. And we have a discretionary policy. We have a discretionary system. So anything that's in NPF4 and in the development plan can be discussed and negotiated around. So stronger language is helpful in identifying the lines, the red, you know, if you like, a red line, which defines what is and isn't acceptable. But at the moment, we still have a lot of these exceptions, except where there's an overarching need, except where this cannot be achieved by other means. And that's those loopholes are, unfortunately, loopholes that some developers persist in exploiting. And in authorities that have an under-resourced planning team, those loopholes get bigger and bigger. And as Lee says, we continue to get applications that really don't meet the spirit or the letter of design guidance. They don't meet many of the existing policies, and yet they still get consent. And sometimes, I think, as Robbie Calvert pointed out earlier, those decisions can be guided by feelings about success at appeal. So if we turn it down at this stage, then the developer may appeal, and how likely are they to be successful, and can we afford as an authority to defend that appeal? And that's with the really unfortunate side of implementation, and that's why we need clarity here and a much tighter definition of terms. There are some terms that are not defined in the glossary at the back, and there are many terms that are defined in a way that I'm not sure is entirely correct or detailed enough to be able to be defensible.
That's helpful, thank you. And my second question was with regards to opportunities for proper consultation to take place with stakeholders. Now, I think we've expressed concern that both this committee's inquiry and work, and also the Scottish Government's consultation work, are both running beside each other during this time. So I just wanted to ask the panel if you think there's any other opportunities for people to feed in, and whether or not that is one of your concerns. And especially given the pandemic, I would say that making this a priority for people to actually be aware of NPF4 and actually be able to see what this means for their communities is maybe not been the best time either. So happy for anyone to come in on that if there's anything they wanted to add.
We've got Cliff. Caroline and then Cliff.
Thanks. I was struck when I looked at the draft that it's very long, and it's more than 100 pages. It has various annexes and supporting documents, and it is as wordy as anything. And I've been a planner, chartered town planner, for many years now, so reading it to me, it's I can understand it, and I can understand what its intentions are. But I think if you're not a planner, and if you're not a policy person, if you are a regular resident of a community interested in planning issues, this is extremely off-putting. Much of the information is, if you like, a geographical assessment of different parts of the country, and I think that's a really interesting section. But yes, it's extremely wordy the way it's written, and I think we have to think really critically about this, about the purpose of these documents. And I think for the national projects, it also strikes me that there is no linking in the document between those national projects and any of the outcomes that are also specified. It's not clear if you just picked up one at random. We've got a description of the project and its need, but no link through to how this is what national outcomes it's going to help with. So there are big issues. There are also not just a blizzard of consultations around all of the planning things, but there are many other things happening too. So we've got consultations live on transport issues. So we've got the car reduction target route map that's just come out. We've got various other things that are also on the table. So for organisations working in and around land use, it's an extremely busy time. So that's tricky. And I think that adds an extra burden for the community. I have some radical ideas about community consultation because of the issues around who talks, how much they say, whose voices are loudest, and the overburdening of successive consultations about strategic and then detailed and historic and then transport and air quality and low emission zones and post-colonial slavery legacy. As citizens, we are bombarded with these things. So I think we should think radically about some of the ways we do this, but perhaps isn't the moment to share those ideas with you. But I think there are some really significant questions about the burden on both professional stakeholders and citizen stakeholders.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'd like to hear those views. So it's maybe something you could provide to the committee in writing so we can include that in our work. As well. I also had Professor Haig and Professor Sparks come in.
Yeah, I agree with Caroline on this point. I think I just make a couple of points. I think, you know, I've got kind of great sympathy for the team in Victoria Quay who were putting this together. I think they were dealt a very difficult hand with the decision in the 2019 Act to combine the MPF with the Scottish Planning Policy. And although I think that's been useful in many ways, because we've been having a lot of the discussion this morning has been about how you actually connect those two things more rigorously. I think it almost guaranteed a document that was going to be kind of quite long and quite difficult to digest. So I think that's necessarily still a work in progress. Second point I just make is that, you know, with my Coburn Association hat on, I mean, we're probably one of the you know, strongest local associations in Scotland with a long history, and we're able to employ two staff, the equivalent of two staff full time. But there is so much going on, it's almost impossible for us to actually, you know, respond to everything and to do that in a way that we would really like to. So I think these are important questions, and I had another point that I've forgotten, so I'll shut up.
Thank you. And Professor Sparks?
This may not be the area that you started off with, but I think at the local consultation level, there's a big job to be done. Through the work of the Social Renewal Board last year and also the Town Centre Action Plan Review, the one thing we heard in common was that communities and people in places did not feel they had a way of getting their voice heard, and it was a very difficult thing for them. Things were done to them rather than being done with them or them co-producing that. I think there's a lot of work to be done at that level of the consultation elements. That consultation is probably the wrong word to be using in those terms in any case.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you, Miles. And I'm now going to I'm going to sweep up and pick up a question that skipped over earlier. So this is around the MPF for policies. So do the policies set out in draft MPF 4 make provision for meaningful public engagement in the plan making and development management processes? And if not, what changes would you like to see made? And I'll start with Caroline on that one.
There are definitely things that can be improved. I have to confess that's not something that I focused on in terms of what I've taken out of looking at NPF4, so I haven't really engaged with that process thing. I'm not sure anything much has changed, but yeah, always things to improve with that. You know, we talked earlier about women and children and disabled groups and underrepresented groups, and I think there's always questions about how we are able to involve them in the planning system, and I don't see anything here that addresses those concerns or, you know, difficulties.
Thank you for that. And Cliff, do you have anything to add on that?
Just I remember what I was going to say to Miles Briggs, which was that, yeah, I think it would be more helpful if the Parliament had a pause between the end of the inputs on MPF4 and its own decisions on it, rather than tying those two things together. I think I think there's a logic in the sort of top-down approach. We've said we want consistency. We said that these are really important priorities. So you have to accept that some of that means that things get fixed in MPF4 that are going to cascade down. The problem then becomes that nobody knew about MPF4 until it actually hits with an application on the ground in their own area. I think there's been very little media coverage that I've seen, and I think that's when you think about it, that's really quite surprising, given that we're talking decisions that affect the whole of Scotland over the next 20 odd years. You might have thought that some of these were more important in the report of a hit and run accident, in somewhere, or a break in at a shop, but this sort of thing doesn't seem to make it to the national news. I don't know whether MSPs can help in this, in that you tend to have more access to an audience than perhaps other people do. But I do think we need to raise the awareness of what's going on at the moment, that there is this important consultation going on, which really will have impacts, and people should be encouraged to have a say. The other thing, I think, coming back, a theme running through the morning has really been this about how all this stuff hits the ground and what you can do. And there are approaches that go under the heading of tactical urbanism, which are really about kind of micro level interventions, some of them temporary, some of them, some of those occasional, I think somebody talked about the abandoned site that's standing on a corner there, and what can we do with it? Well, tactical urbanism says, hey, we can make a community garden here, let's get on with it. And I think what we need would be something that actually gave much more empowerment at that local level to act within the spirit of MPF4, because the difficulty with any top-down thing, and again it's been touched on, is each place is different, and you have to actually tailor the good intentions and the overall policy to the specifics of topography. We talked earlier about where the river's near the city centre, whatever. All this local complexity is a great strength if we can actually tap into it effectively. And that means giving people power at the local level to act, and supporting organisations and institutions at a local level that can do that. And we had Paz on earlier, who I think, confession of interest, I'm a patron of Paz. We need those kind of facilitating interface bodies to actually provide support at local level.
Thanks for that response, and I thank you for giving us the term tactical urbanism. That's brilliant. Thank you. Lee Sparks, you want to come in on this?
Yeah, my sense is that much of the consultation and engagement that's done through local authorities is very traditional. I think Caroline said about some of the groups that are not engaged in that way. I think we need to think of new ways of engaging a range of people, and also doing it much earlier than we have. So, again, more to be done in terms of those areas. And I think there is a question about resourcing and capacity building was used in the earlier session about how do we do that. I again agree we're under-resourced, and we have fortuitous places that have good community assets that can do that. We have others that we really need to get that engagement, but we need to think of new ways of engaging. A bit too traditional, a bit too done to people. And a sense is we need to alter that.
Thank you. And I'm now going to bring in questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning again to the panel. I'm hoping you heard the discussion with the first panel, and I would like to touch base with you on the three issues I raised with them. The first one is about funding and engaging the private sector in some of this, and the second one is whether we can and how we can strengthen our powers relating to derelict shops and buildings within the urban landscape, and the third one is about how we try to help redevelop our town centres given the problems we have with flood risk assessments, which seem to be on the increase. So the first question, maybe, I don't know, by Caroline, we spoke to the Celebrate Kilmarnock team, local people, Caroline, and some of the council officials and members yesterday about the work they're doing there in Kilmarnock. And much of the the achievements they've made there have been done without the NPF4 being in place. So it was really an issue about funding and support. They've achieved that through town centre regeneration funding and common good money. But as I understand it, there's no private sector contribution to that. How do we open this up to embrace and engage with the private sector better? Because they've got a stake in the redevelopment and the success of the town centres too. So do you have any ideas how we could reach out and do that better?
Very good answers from the first panel on this about the carrots and the sticks. And also the point that I was making about mixed use developments where we get units that are provided but never occupied by business. So there's something to be thought of about, again, this is about delivery and implementation, about, if you like, animation, so business animation and support that might be required for startups or for social enterprises and these sorts of things. But I think a really interesting idea to come back to is that business is not separate to community, that businesses are still people and residents are people. And anything which allows us to engage communities in their places will bring business with it, because those people are businesses. They have the capacity in some cases to make new businesses. And I think where people see activity going on, I think it was Barbara Cummins said that, you know, that can bring people along and they go, oh, there's something happening. Okay, well, maybe we can paint our shop front, or maybe we can put some money into this. So, you know, a kind of classic pump priming, I guess, using those small funds to bring people. But it's people, businesses are people. And I think anything we can do will help there. But it's many strands together. It isn't one thing, as always. There isn't a silver bullet, sadly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks for that. And it kind of leads me into the second part of this. We heard also in Kilmarnock and any town in Scotland about the difficulties in dealing with, you know, empty derelict shops, buildings and land, abandonment, and particularly in the urban setting. Most of this stuff is all in private ownership. And it's really to ask you if you think we have sufficient powers to deal with this, or is that the right way to go about it? I mean, I have a number of local examples where buildings and shops in the town of Kilmarnock that I represent, and approaching their managing agents to even clean them has proven almost impossible. So it seems to me that some of them prefer to retain ownership of the properties but do nothing to improve the look and feel. And that contributes to the overall sense of decay in the town centre. And it's to ask you, how do we turn that around? How do we engage with those owners, agents or otherwise, so that they can take a stake in this and actually be part of the redevelopment of the towns? Could I maybe try Cliff and see if you have some views on that to offer, please, Cliff?
Yeah, it's hugely important topic, so thanks for bringing this up. And I heard the discussion earlier, which I'd agree with Caroline, made some important points. I think we need to disaggregate the private sector a bit. I mean, private sector's everything from, you know, the startup shop run by a 25-year-old, there's the family firm that's always been there running the furniture shop in the city centre, or, you know, there's the property ownership company, there's the hedge fund behind them. So, you know, it isn't a single entity. I think in terms of work I did on small towns for BEF some years ago now, looked across a number of towns in Scotland, and I think we found a number of interesting things, that the biggest problems were properties and sites that were owned remotely from the town. The flip side of that is that your local businesses, the ones which are really rooted in the town, are probably the starting point in trying to get something done. Having said that, I remember going up to Forfar, I think it was, and there the local Tesco, I think, was actually sort of leading the attempts to pull the traders together and to get them together into some sort of action. though again, the situation hadn't been helped by the fact that the meeting we had was in the new town, new council offices, which was next to the McDonald's out by the bypass. And the focus for the meeting was how can we revive the town centre where there was lots of empty council offices. Decisions within local authorities also impact. But I think the carrot and stick mentioned is right, but that again is spatialised. There are some places where you actually need the stick because the development demand is very high. It's one of the complaints we've had as the Coburn Association in Edinburgh, that a situation where firms would only want to come to Edinburgh, with due respect to other MSPs, they're not going to go perhaps to other parts of Scotland, but they're still given quite an easy ride when the council could actually negotiate a hard bargain there. Whereas in other areas, you do need the carrot because the reality is the investment isn't going to go in unless there is the carrot. So I think, again, it's this intelligence system, this action on the ground. We need agents for change who are actually rooted in those communities, in those city centres, town centres, and liaising with all the players and identifying their unique selling points. One thing that struck me from that study that I did was that almost every town we went to actually had one company or maybe a public sector organisation that was really a leader. You know, many of these were trading in global markets, making widgets or whatever, but they were niches and they didn't seem to follow through to pull the whole of the private sector in that town together with the council, together with the community, to create the kind of interlinkage that all the research tells you is what's needed for a place to really take off again.
I mean, that's really interesting to hear that, Cliff, but what stick is it you think we need to deploy to get property owner to even clean their building? I mean, I've tried several times and they point blank refuse. I mean, we've got amenity notices, I know about that, but I don't think they're used widely because I think ultimately the responsibility falls back to the council if they serve it and the work's not done. So what on earth is it we can do? I mean, some of the buildings are covered in graffiti or circus posters or, you know, weeds growing out of pavements and doorways and stuff. I mean, how on earth do we tackle that kind of thing with whatever carrot and whatever stick we have at our disposal to deploy?
Yeah, I don't know if you can shame them into it. I mean, it is a very difficult issue. Whether you could offer them a kind of community cleanup scheme, but more fundamentally, I think is the situation where somebody's just sitting on an empty property. Because it's part of their property portfolio, and they, you know, that they're trying to rent it for a price that they might get in, you know, Reading or somewhere like that, but is unrealistic in some of the locations in Scotland. And I just again refer back to the Scottish Land Commission, and I think we have to get back into a situation where there's an active public sector led regeneration in places that are not going to be regenerated simply through allowing the market to operate. Some places will, not everywhere will, and those that won't, we need the drive and the powers to acquire land and buildings and repurpose them.
Thank you for that, Cliff. My third question, probably invite Professor Sparks in on this. You might have heard me asking earlier, Professor Sparks, about in East Ayrshire, the local development plans, they find it very difficult to repurpose and reuse brownfield sites for housing or for anything really that are adjacent and adjoining the rivers because of the problems we have with flood risk, which seems to be on the increase, and we know that. Have you any thoughts about how we can possibly do anything to overcome that? It certainly won't be done short term, but if we're serious about the success of the NPF4 and how to regenerate towns and build them for communities, we need to solve that problem about inner urban redevelopment. And if we take into account the flood risk assessment, how do we possibly marry the two to give town centres some hope of recovery post COVID and post anything else, really?
Thanks, Willie. I had my hand up about 7 minutes ago or so, can I try and tackle all three of your questions?
Absolutely, thanks.
I thought the convener pop in so briefly. Firstly, Cliff said it. I think there's a danger of when we say private sector, I think you do need to split the private sector into large and small, and about the local elements of the private sector. I think they do operate in different ways. I think there are some big private sector companies and big private businesses that want to do things. And sometimes we sort of tar them all with the same thing. So I think it needs to be more nuanced about how we get the private sector involved. And I think local businesses, local community organisations, social enterprise are really very important in that. But big private sector operators will be important to us as part of it. Secondly, the local ownership, the absentee landlord point of view, demonstrates why community wealth building is. They are actually from the community and part of the community, and that means we do need to take on more of those assets and get more of that back into ownership in the way that Cliff was suggesting. And I also think in terms of some of the issues around vacant and derelict buildings and the way you're talking about what the Scottish Land Commission will say, I think is going to be really important. If we think about some of those absentee landlords and agents, where are they most worried about things? It's in their pocket. So I think we need to think about financial aspects, how we become much stronger in making sure that they realise the cost to them if they keep on the behaviours they're doing at the moment. So I think that becomes really important. I think there is a flip side, though. And I wonder, and you mentioned the Amenity Act, the Amenity Orders and other things. Councils, and certainly some of those I've been talking to, have lost that sense of robust enforcement and engagement on a constant basis. And I do think building the confidence of councils and planners to actually do things becomes really very important. But there's also a piece around the confidence for private investment that councils are going to do things for the place. So the situations I described earlier in Stirling, where we've got councillors, members going against officers to allow an out-of-town development, private investors in the city centre are going, what is this about? Why do I have confidence in you? Your final point about floods, I'm not an expert about flooding and building what you can do there. I think there are elements about how we retrofit and rebuild some of the buildings within town centres as a consequence of that. But we do have to look at where those, I think some of those floods are coming from. Towns are not that microcosm in the one place. They are part of that. The river is part of that catchment. Where can we do other things elsewhere to ameliorate things on towns, as well as what we can do with the building side of it? But as I said, I'm not an expert on flooding risk at all. I hope that covered all three of them, Willie. I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's really very helpful to all three of you. Thanks so much for that. Thank you. And back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. Yes, there were useful responses. I think we're going to need to do a session on the whole derelict high street piece. We can really dig down into it, because I know there are some good examples out there. We've got a few more minutes before we end, but maybe we're done. But I just wanted to just put out to all three of you if there's any other points that you want to raise about the MPF4 that we've not already, it's not already been highlighted through the questions that we've asked you. So if there's anything you've got, I'll just pause for a moment and see if anyone puts an R in the chat. Okay, so I think Caroline did put an R in the chat. So Caroline, please come on in and
tell us some more. Just to pick up that last point, which is about flooding, and Lee made the point there about catchments, and I wanted to say that. So instead of just thinking about the town centre in isolation, we need to think about the catchment. And this is where NPF4 is actually quite helpful, because it's talking about blue and green infrastructure. And of course, one of the really important words that I wanted to mention, which I think hasn't been talked about enough, is about retrofit. It ties in completely with that point about the proportion of the built environment that will still be here in 2045, so that 84%, 85%. But we have to upgrade the existing built environment, and that includes dealing with surface water issues through the addition of rain gardens and other green infrastructure and blue infrastructure. So the way that we manage water in the built environment is really important and affects those bigger flooding questions, and it may make some sites much easier to continue using, and we have to recognise again that there are going to be some necessary sacrifices that have to be made, and there will be sites that continue to be unable to be developed safely without radical reimagining. And we can look to the Netherlands and other places for floating buildings and buildings on stilts and things like that. Sheffield has some nice examples of architecture with ground floor garages, living or retail space above that, so that in a flood event, the low value item, the cars and things are flooded, but the high value parts of the building are not. So there are some things like that that can be done. But I think retrofit is really important. How we link new development to upgrading existing development. And there was a place in the draft which talks about the requirement for rapid decarbonisation of our homes. And we cannot meet that decarbonisation requirement by simply focusing on new build. We have to retrofit. And how do we do it? And again, I go back to the acquiring money, investment to do that, and potentially using our infrastructure levy as a way of upgrading existing built stock. So I'll finish on that, I'll let the others come in, but I just wanted to mention retrofit, really important word that I think we need to grapple with. I'm not sure, again, as others have said, that's reflected in the draft currently.
I think that was a really brilliant point to bring up, Caroline. I've definitely been grappling with retrofit lately myself. Cliff, you want to come in and then Lee, and then we'll wrap it up.
Okay, yeah, I think this discussion on flooding in city centres really, you know, actually is kind of makes a lot of other points. I mean, one reason we're having flood risk, yes, there's external climate change, which is difficult for us to have much impact upon locally, but we've also sealed lots of land by out-of-town retailing with large car parks. We've sealed land with housing developments that did not have sustainable urban drainage systems. So the runoff that is hitting the town centre downstream is increased from what it was. And that's happened under the watch of a planning system that's been there for 80 years. So we can't carry on as we have been. You know, there has to be change. And I go back particularly to the housing section on that. So you need to look at the whole water catchment system to actually tackle the fate of Kilmarnock Town Centre. Just finally, and thanks to everybody for listening and everything. There was a question earlier on in the first session about human rights, and I would refer people to the United Cities and Local Government, who've got a world charter, I think, on human rights in the city, or words to that effect, or to promote a publication I was involved in. Did this for the South African Local Government Association, South African Government, and UN Habitat. And we've got a chapter in here about human rights in the city. And I'm happy to, you know, to provide a summary of that to, I can't remember which member of the committee it was now, I'm afraid, who asked that. But it is really important issue, and not least the right to adequate housing.
Thank you, Cliff. That was great. Yes, that was Eleanor who asked the question, but of course we're all interested, so we'd be very grateful to that. And thanks for pointing us to the United Cities and Global Government Charter. That's brilliant. Lee.
Just a final thought following that discussion about retrofit and other things. We need, I think, to make sure, and it may not be strictly a NPF 4 point, that the relative costs of doing the things we want to happen in town centres and the relative costs of retrofitting things are better than the costs of out-of-town development and of new build. And I don't think we've got that cost balance right. So we need incentives right, and we need the disincentives. There's an awful lot of talk around about the incentives and the encouragements. I think we need to be much stronger and more active on the disencouragements and the disincentives to do the things we don't want to happen. And that may also include things that have already been built. And Cliff's point about floods coming from the out-of-town asphalt that we've put absolutely everywhere is a good illustration of that. We've caused these problems over the last 50 plus years. We now need to realise how we can actually start using the powers we have to change those behaviours of things that are there already, as well as stopping the new stuff happening that's adverse.
Thanks very much for that response. And as a Highlands and Islands MSP, I'm certainly grappling with, I think, planning, trying to catch up with our new understanding about peatland, for example, where we've got, you know, projects where they've been received planning consent on peatland, probably at a time a few years ago when we didn't really understand how peatland can help us with our carbon emissions if we look after it well. So there's a bit of that kind of like, do we need to put a halt to those things that are already going ahead and reconsider what we're doing? So thank you so much for spending the time with us this morning, and we went into the afternoon. It's been really very, very useful. I wish we had time for all of your 1 hour lectures on all of your different topics that you really know so much about. Potentially in the coming years, we'll see you again for other evidence sessions. In the meantime, I'm going to move on to the next item on our agenda, and that is the second item is the consideration of the Council Tax Dwellings and Part Residential Subjects Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021, SSI 2021/489. This is a negative instrument, and there is no requirement on the committee to make any recommendations on it. Can I ask committee members if they have any comments they would like to make? I don't see anyone wanting to make any comments. That's great. Is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Okay, so confirming that the committee, no committee members do not want to make any recommendations in relation to the. As agreed, as part of our approach to MPF4, we'll now consider the evidence we've just heard in private, and I now close the public part of the meeting, and we'll move into private and meet at 12:40. Thank you.